Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Winter Championships 2016. This is game number one in the best of seven series between Lord Raphael and Kanisi. Absolutely. The winner of this series, since this is the semi-finals, the winner of this series will progress to the grand finals, and the loser will be eliminated. This is single bracket elimination, of course. No second chances, and today we're bringing you a replay from a recorded game, which is actually significantly more awkward than actually casting it live without a replay, because we don't have Azamp's UI, among other things, but
we'll make it
talk about that. But what do we have here? Looks like I'm putting 60 food up from the bat. There is Lord Raphael. The matchup, let's turn the Fog of War off. We do have Lord Raphael in the north of the map, and the color blue playing is indeed the Russians. 200 wood start, gonna leave one of those on the floor. Isn't gonna need that, isn't gonna go for a mark. It indicates that he perhaps wants to go up pretty quickly with a 14 villager age up. Looks like he's gonna find some sheep. And has he found any treasures on the way?
Nothing really. I'm fully expecting to see a 14 village up. Kind of interested to see Russia come into play here, considering it is game one and it's free pick, and Russia's pretty well known to be the lowest on the tier list of all the civs. So already kind of an interesting start to the series, right? Seeing Lord Raphael opt to play Russia, he may have something to show us that I'm not aware of, and maybe the rest of the viewers aren't either. So I'm looking forward to seeing what that may be.
I'm looking to see what it is. As you mentioned, a new donation cut. $50 from Purple Squid. Thanks for casting, he says.
Wow,
no problem,
thank you.
Purple Squid. That, I believe, brings us up to $450 raised in one series plus the first 2 minutes of another game. So thank you so much to everybody. We weren't actually sure if a Summer Championships tournament would go ahead, because we're not sure if we'd actually raise enough money. A Spring Championships. We thought we'd have to wait until the summer. But maybe we will actually get a spring one after all. So thank you very much to everybody who has donated. If you're watching this as a VOD and you'd like to contribute as well, these tournaments, $1,000 each of these are worth, and are brought to you, of course, by ESO-community.net. There will be a link in the description. They'll tell you how to do all of that. But Russia will be interesting to see. As you mentioned, is fairly low on the tier list. I think next is Spain. But even Spain, I think, might be stronger than Russia due to the slight increase on their Lancer shipments and Rod Elleros. But let's introduce the matchup we do have in the south of the map, in the color red. British, we haven't announced that just yet. British versus Russia. This matchup, I think, is better for Russia than a lot of other matchups, so it will be interesting to see. I think it's fairly even, and you're expecting a 14 villager age up, you say. So far, everything seems to be in accordance with exactly that. So many llamas, look at that. I would flare the minimap, but you wouldn't be able to see that.
Yeah, I'm watching, I see, so Raphael just wrangling in those llamas is going to help him out quite a bit. Kanisi picking up 90 food, that's going to be nice for him. I'm not sure if that will convert into an earlier age up. It will not, he's already clicked up. The classic 17 villager age up, all the builds going onto wood. I mean, I don't know about you, but it feels like this is just going to be a super standard game in a matchup that I just haven't seen in so long. And I just don't know. I'm not really sure how Russia's going to be able to overcome being Russia.
Yeah.
It is an OTP map, which favors Russia quite a bit in most matchups, but it's British, right? British don't need TPs,
yeah,
so.
That's true.
It's kind of this.
$5 coming in from Mama Smurf. He says, happy birthday, Mito, I believe.
Happy birthday, Mito.
Happy birthday, Mito. Happy belated birthday. Thank you very much for the $5. We'll add that to the pool of money, and we'll keep you updated on how much that is. Lots of generosity today. Thank you very much. But yeah, British, they don't need trading posts. You're right. There is no trading post on this map, so it makes sense that, well, to be fair, they both had an equal opportunity to click into this matchup. They could change civs if they wanted to, if they weren't happy. So it is interesting to see what Lord Raphael has in store for us today. We will see. 80 coin treasure going to be picked up. Explorer is coming in hot on that. Doesn't look like he'll be able to get there in time, though.
But Bill's moving up, even more importantly. Raphael is showing us what you'd expect. And recently I've been kind of toying around with the fact that pretty much if you try to build a blockhouse where he's building it as Russia, you should lose all your bills and have to resign.
Yeah.
Because, you should always have gold for minutes on hand and always be scouting for it. Obviously, that's not the case here. And he's able to establish this blockhouse, which, that makes Russia way stronger when you've got a blockhouse on their second hunt. As you can see, Kanisi totally unaware of the blockhouse going down, just inches away from all of his bills and that 75 wood treasure. So,
yeah.
But this tower coming down, I can't wait to see the reaction from, because Raphael knows it, right? He can see the dead animal, but I can't wait to see the reaction from both players when their towers kind of materialize on top of each other.
Yeah, sadly we do not have the chat here, so we can't actually see that. The only reaction we're going to get is the way they play the game. It looks like Lord Raphael managing to push that Explorer back towards that enhanced combat. Looks like that's going to die. Of course, Kinesi did manage to pick up that, I believe, 80 coin treasure. But, of course, that alerted the blue player to the whereabouts of where he was, and he, of course, went after that. Five Cossacks are on the way. That is a benefit we can have from casting a recorded game, though. We get to see the shipments that are on the way. Five Cossacks going to be opening with that. There is a tower here on top. Going to send those...
Sharing is caring there on that one, hurtable, right?
Trying to get that as close as he can, that base, right? This hunt towards his base. Sharing is caring? What happened?
Oh, they just were both gathering off of that one hurtable.
Oh, yeah,
they
were. Yeah, I thought you meant... Well, you said hurtable, and I thought sheep, but never mind.
Oh, sorry, yeah. One hunt. My bad. I should have said hunt. And, I like that the tower is firing on the Vils right now. He's basically forcing Kinesi to be on top of his game and redirect that tower onto something else.
Ooh, is he
already
get
missing one power shot.
Okay,
Kinesi spending the 50 wood for the gate. Definitely smart of him to do that. He's all walled in now. And at this point, you know, what do you do as Lord Raphael here? I mean, look at how turtleable this map is. It is just completely shut down. Even that gap on the left is closed. I'm watching these Cossacks, and just I'm probably as surprised as he is to see how well closed off that is. And look at these longbow poking the Vils right at the edge, making it, you know, not he's even getting more damage off just by, you know, having those four longbows at the gate.
Yeah, forcing that villager into the town center here. Strela do get in range, though, and are going to attack these longbow, but now going to get out of range safely behind a wall there and going to provide a bit of range damage. The Russian player, it looks like he is going to be able to take out this town center. Sorry, this trading... No, tower. Outpost.
Yeah.
Yes, that's the word. That is the word attributed to that building there. Is he going to be able to save it? That is the question. Looks like he's perhaps
that's
trying to lure these cavalry in. Strela on their own have almost no siege, so bringing the longbow out of the gates keeps the cavalry interested and moves them away from the outpost. Is he waiting, perhaps, for a shipment or a batch of units? I can't flick on over to see that's in queue.
I don't think he is. I think Kinesi's just turtling, and this is a huge win for Kinesi. Like, he's managed to make Raphael make 20 Strelitz and ship 5 Cossacks just for a chance to feed them into longbows at a gate.
Yeah.
And all he's going to get for it is a 250 wood tower that, to be perfectly honest, isn't going to change anything about Kinesi's defendability.
Yeah, plenty of hunts and mines in the back already. He's completely safe, right? He can stay in this base for quite a while and, you know, fully turtled up with a shell. And as you're mentioning with these longbowmen, they can just sit behind this and do what British likes to do on this map.
Yeah, and you look at the villager difference. You know, Kinesi didn't house boom too hard, right? So he's sitting on 33 vills, 80 shrine pop, or house pop. I always call it shrine pop. and, you know, Raphael at the same time sitting on only 20 villagers, though, right? I mean, he's been building vills, sure, but realistically speaking, Russia just can't keep up with British economics, right? So Kinesi also already sending 5 vills. Now he's sending 700 coin, which I expect he'll use to age up. And look at this. He's walling in. He's got like two different layers of walls. Like this little pocket on the left is just completely isolated already. But then he's got this wall in the bottom corner too.
Yeah, adding this one in. This was like this was an extra wall added in later. And just completely denying it the entry for anything. This is just really indicative of exactly how Kinesi likes to play, right? Walls everywhere, despite the nerf on the walls, still making full use of them there, and clearly showing us that they're actually still quite useful. But 700 coin coming in, and with the resources he has currently, a lot of food there, and I imagine they'll have all the food. He'll have 1,200 food by the time that 700 gold is collected up. Gonna hit up to the next stage. Very safe to do that. Enough long women to sit behind this wall, and of course the wall is gonna stop anything incoming or providing a bit of extra time should something come in. Lord Raphael, in the meantime, though, has sent steel traps, I believe. He is gearing up to play a longer game, getting all his market techs and all of those things. But again, as you mentioned, not going to be able to keep up with British, most likely. He's going to have to make something happen. Lord Raphael, by the looks of it, gearing up to send 700 coin age up himself. $2 does come in from Jerem. Can you try... It's so small, I can't read it. I'm going to have to make that bigger. but what were you going to say, H2M?
I was going to say, I think, you know, it seems like Raphael's just a step behind all the way through these builds, right? He's lost 7 Strelitz to this harassment at the tower. He lost 1 Cossack, effectively, from HP loss. He is putting down another blockhouse, but Kinesi's not going to ever push that, right? You almost want to see that would be in the bank for... And he's building an artillery foundry, too.
Is he?
Interesting. Really probably want to see that 250 wood be available for housing space and cannons, right? So, I may have gotten a few seconds ahead of you. I'll pause it and resync, but yeah, so the artillery foundry coming down, but that blockhouse is almost a liability at this point. You know, he needs every little resource he can get if he's going to effectively push into these walls, and you know, Kinesi just showing us that it's that, you know, a wall is a wall, whether it has 3,000 HP or 1,500 HP, it's still a good building, right? So, five wood.
It is, absolutely. But Lord Raphael has managed to click on up to the next stage, and as you mentioned, yeah, the foundry is there. I'll be interested to see how he distributes his villagers here. Yeah, plenty going on gold, right? You know, that coin mine in the back there, going out fast with, by the looks of it, 15 villagers on that, 5 villagers only on food. Redistributed his villager production, clearly to make falconets here. The question is, you know, how is he going to protect those? He's going to need some sort of infantry. He does have a bit of food, maybe some muskets will come out, or maybe something else. Certainly stellar shipments available, but that, you know, that is on the cards. Lord Raphael clearly gearing up to be making falconets by the looks of it. But let's switch on over to Kinesi, see what he is up to. Has the age up almost complete as well, continuing to make musket production to complement his longbows, and most likely get the veterancy upgrades and continue building manors everywhere in the way that he's already been doing. So a nice boon from from Kinesi and Lord Raphael. We'll have to see how effective his push will be with those cannons, right?
You know what's bizarre about this? If you look at, as you pointed out, look at what Kinesi's doing, actually. Well, he just messed up his wall, but look at what Kinesi's actually doing, right? He's got 110 house pop, only 40 vills, he's FF behind this, he's making units totally normal. He's shipping 2 Falcs, he's got 2 racks, he's a stable.
Yep.
He's in no way vulnerable behind the wall whatsoever. And Lord Raphael arguably over-adapting here by, you know, he's making a couple cav archers, but he's not even teching vet tech. Instead, he's opting to train falconets because, as you can tell, right, he's expecting Kinesi to be 50 bills behind that wall, right?
Yeah.
And look at just throwing up more and more troll walls everywhere. Like, he's just, the entire map is segmented under his control, and that's what happens when you give Kinesi time to macro or make this, you know, spend his APM. He spends it on these 5 wood, you know, 50 wood segments that just completely control the game.
Yeah, that's exactly how Kinesi likes to play. He creates a very safe area, makes it very difficult to raid him because he's fully wedged in here. Everything's fine. If one wall does go down, he just walks into a different area, which is a different section of wall all closed off. And these walls, I know, always impress Zuta. On this map, he's actually able to close off a lot of places where on more open maps, he's not able to do that. So actually here, he's walling even more effective than usual there. He's not, as you mentioned, at fill of 50 villagers. That's what perhaps Lord Raphael is expecting. He can't scout behind there to see what is going on. Cannons fairly exposed on the front, but does manage to take out that one there that he
had trained. Shot for shot. Yeah, but 2 Falcs are going to pop out of the blockhouse for sure. Popping out the back end of it, unfortunately. And
does take out a Falc with his cannons, and chooses to get out of there, and narrowly down to 1 Falc. Now, Lord Raphael in the commanding position with regards to Falcs, but I think Kinesi has the stronger economy and clearly more units in this fight right now. Is he going to lose that cannon?
It's no. Packing.
He's good.
Go.
I know there's a tiny bit of a time delay between mining and H2O.
We're pretty much dead on, actually. I've been watching it, so
okay.
I was just watching that cannon pack up, and yeah, so third cannon popping out right now, and Kinesi has established that pocket. And
2 balls from Mama Smurf. Hide progress bar, please. I will do that for the next match, but not this one, I'm afraid. But thank you for pointing that out. Yeah, we'll absolutely do that. And thank you for the $2. Always goes to a good cause. Funding more tournaments, absolutely. Here, though, this is what Lord Raphael had been setting up to do. You know, he saw those two cannons. He saw the walls, and he made artillery go up to the Fortress Age, and this is where he wants to start pushing and doing some damage. But we can see artillery foundry of Kinesi's own has gone up, made a culverin, and that is really going to shut, making a culverin, sorry, and that's going to make it very difficult, going to shut down the very safe way to shut down these artillery, right?
Yeah, but look at Kinesi. So he, like I said, he plays British differently from other people. He's not just booming behind this. He's actually at threat of being housed. You almost want to see Lord Raphael take out those 3 houses and start putting a little bit of pain on Kinesi to gather some wood here. But you know, Raphael not opting to do that, unfortunately for him. Kinesi, look, he's at 120 out of 130 pop. He could have maybe even denied the second culverin just by killing a couple houses here. You know, Kinesi is continuing to mass, continuing to wall up the map, and you know, another thing would be nice to see, you know, a couple Opries come out here and just start, you know, sitting on the walls and just putting, even if they're not killing villas, at least just keep the map from being, you know.
Does have some form of a raid, though, coming in, but actually I think he's not realized the walls are there. He was actually coming in for a raid and then is met by a wall and is now actually on his way back. He's like, oh damn, yeah, Prishnitz would have been But, you know, much better there in that case. But Megan's concern is Prechniks don't do very much. They're not very good cavalry. They're only good against villagers. But certainly adding in a few where you can would be really nice for the reasons you're mentioning. But that, maybe that's the reason it hasn't for the time being. But certainly lots of walls. They'll be very good. Has a culverin of his own now, so there is that. But the longer this game goes, right, Khaleesi getting further and further ahead. Lord Raphael only on 38 villagers. Khaleesi on 49, you know, over 10 villagers ahead. And that's quite the number considering the upgrades that I'm sure he has as well. Or actually, both players will have. Starting to siege this. What do we have? Three cannons coming in.
I thought he was going to go in with his falconets there, and that would have been just... Actually, it would have been detrimental.
Yeah, flying. Against these two culverins in the back, that would have been really quite,
Luckily, his culverin does get off a couple shots here, and he's going to pick it up. He doesn't know that Khaleesi has two culverins yet of his own, that last volley being, you know, a free kill. But these two culverins are going to shoot, kill the opponent's culverin, and now Khaleesi's up two culverins to nil. And look at Lord Raphael, just he's not playing well. Like, he's got 1,000 food, 1,000 wood, and 400 gold in the bank. Yeah. And this is what happens when you play, you know, 20 seconds of command lag in Khaleesi game. You're playing his game, and you can't macro, right? So we see tons of units dying to these three falconets, just trying to kite away without getting quite in range of the culverins. Raphael doing an insanely good job here, but ooh, can the falconets need to fire? And there they go, taking a couple more nice shots. Oops, stacked on top of each other though, and the culverin's melting them away.
Yeah, that area damage.
At this point, it's the spend difference, right? Raphael floating now 1.4k food, 800 wood, 600 gold. And, you know, if that was all invested in units right now, Khaleesi would never be pushing out of his base. There's no way with another 20 units here that this push would have been effective. But as is the case, he's getting pushed off here. I mean,
hasn't been able to spend those resources. Only got this one foundry, blockhouse as well. As no blockhouses now, so gonna have to rebuild them in his deface there. So two going up in the back. As you mentioned, if he had 20 more units there, certainly he'd still be in his base, right? And Khaleesi's running out of food. Actually, no, he's not. But
he should be, right? I mean, if Raphael spent his resources, he could have been pushing the corner with the food with a way bigger army and even just sack his front base, but. You know, that fight was going incredibly well for Khaleesi, and now Lord Raphael playing catch-up. Well, Khaleesi is still just flawlessly macroed. Five Huss are on the way. He's even just, like, at, you know, 150 Huss pop. He's got Muskets, Phalanx. It's all just kind of rolling in for him right now.
Yep, in a good spot there, pushing out right now. Has the economy and the military advantage. Going to take out this foundry there. And Lord Raphael playing catch-up, as you mentioned. He's going to, you know, come here comes the culverins. They're coming in. Hopefully he'll be able to get a good shot for his sake.
Yeah.
Going to aim for that culverin there. Does go down now. There's nothing there that can counter him other than the culverin in the back.
And he catches the other Falk.
Oh, nice. Oh, he does. Nicely done. Yeah. And here, the longbowmen are going to try and punish him. They're going to try and do some damage. It doesn't look like he has a standing army to punish there. It needs to bring those cav archers forward. It looks like the musketeers
are
just going to walk forward. He knows that he's done a lot of damage to Lord Raphael. He's certain, probably, that there's not going to be anything to punish his musketeers, and that's why he's okay with the advances on the culverins. Does manage to even them up. It does take them out, and not going to be punished for doing that. You know, Lord, these cavalry archers aren't particularly high DPS. Not very punishing to take fire from whilst you're focusing down the culverin. Minutemen are called, and at this point, Strelitz do pop out. Looks like he's got enough units to push this back, actually. But British still in a good spot. Longbowman, more units, another culverin adding in. Looks like he's in a very good spot. Cav might be able to do some good damage here. Actually.
Yeah, I mean, Rudenna's just longbows. Longbows do incredibly well against Cav, and those are H2 Cossacks, but there's also a lot of Strelitz here, and Khaleesi just opting to run away here. You know, the Cossacks making the difference between being able to just take that fight or having to run, and getting a lot of value out of that six Cossack shipment, more than I expected. But Khaleesi smartly cleaning up all the Cav archers right before a big influx of Cav. Look at how many Hussars are on the field right now for Khaleesi. Yeah. He shipped the five and built the five more, it looks like, and that's going to be really scary. Only six Cav archers left to deal with that. And as we know, Cav archers are not the fastest at killing enemy cavalry. So
no, they're no dragoon. They don't have the instant shoot, and they don't have quite as much higher damages as they do. Cav not as effective as I thought they were going to be, but still, still very strong there. Village is going to go down. I think here this is Khaleesi's cue to head on out, but yes, he's perhaps not won this battle, but the war is certainly still in his favor. Look at that 223 score. Currently sitting on, Lord Raphael's on 44 villages, Khaleesi on 62, several villages ahead, and as a result of that, he's just going to be able to remass very, very quickly and head back in, bounce back again, I think. Adding in even more walls, just just adding wolves wherever he can. This is exactly what I'd expect from Khaneesi.
Yep, and if you look at, he's hunting freely in the bottom right-hand corner of the map. Not even using his safe hunt that he's got on the left-hand side. He's just kind of, he's just continuing to gather resources, and that's what Russia needs to prevent, in this matchup. And at, you know, Khaneesi got a second town center up, just continuing to out-eco his opponent. And, it's just come down to macro in a lot of ways, right? If you look at Khaneesi's bank, still it's at zero. And you look at Raphael's, he's still floating 2,000 food. So, you know, that's been kind of the story of what's gotten him to this point.
Yeah. Is there, what can he do with, you know, if he's able to spend all these resources? Can he get back into it, or is this perhaps...
I want to see him drop it. I would have loved to see him drop a town center somewhere on the right and start doing, two times. Because every town center you drop lets you use the Russian bonus, another time almost, right? Because that bonus of faster villagers, cheaper villagers, more town centers lets you continue to snowball off of that.
Yep.
And I feel like if there was a second town center, early fortress, instead of that second blockhouse and foundry, we might have seen a more equal economic game at this point, and Raphael may have been in a better position to play the contain game. But, as it stands now, he's really in a tough spot. And unless this flank on the right catches all 12 of these vills on the hunt down here, he's going to be in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, is that those cavalry archers, though? Have they seen that area of the map? That's the question. It's very on the edge. And
he hasn't scouted it. I'm looking at the final.
Oh, yeah, we can see that, can't we? I forget we have that facility. Yeah, he has not scouted that at all.
TP reveal it.
Oh, this. No, yeah. Not quite.
No, he's looking. He's walking right by it. Oh my gosh.
Wow.
That's so fortunate for Khaneesi.
Yeah, just no knowledge of that happening there at all. Otherwise, he could actually even the game up there. I think.
Look at this position.
That would be an opportunity to absolutely even the game up. So what do we? Wow, that's four falconets and a culverin. So red is now advancing here. Khaneesi, Lord Raphael, his army is. I'm not sure. He doesn't know what to do.
Look at the left. Look at the left. He just gated. Khaneesi just gated.
That's
that.
Where he's going, yeah. If a gate's
he's
being.
He's definitely coming here.
Lots of just villages there, custom strelle there. Yeah, and again,
it's almost like Berg, man. It's like there's just. It's like he's got creep tumors everywhere on the map, right? And, like, he can see everything. His units are at a combat advantage because of the gate potential. And there's 10 vills inside that blockhouse. I mean.
Yeah, they're gonna certainly be at risk. He does find a few villages, though, in the south position there where the villages were. Just find a few, but the majority are still safe on this hunt on these trees up there. Let's turn Lord Raphael's perspective on. He doesn't know they're there, and gathering trees is fairly safe, as you can't actually see trees being chopped quite as easily as you can see hunts being gathered from. You can click on a hunt and of course see the food be going down. Fight is commencing over here. The cannon's really underway. I can hear the bass in my headset, and these houses, they're toast, this blockhouse as well. What is Lord Raphael going to be able to do to stop this? His army is out in the middle of the map, and it's all infantry against their cannons. This is going to be fairly difficult for him to deal with. I see no way to deal with that. He's going to need more culverins of his own, and he doesn't have any in queue at the moment. And even if he did, that's a lot of resources to spend, which he's running out of quickly. These villagers unable to gather, and this impending threat on his doorstep.
Yeah, and I'm not sure what he really does from this position. He hasn't spent. He still hasn't spent all his resources. I've been waiting all game for it, right? But he's just, I think he's at the point of no return where he can't really bolster enough to deal with this anymore. And as the Russian player, when you're out of hunts.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the game number two in this best of seven series between Lord Raphael and Khaneesi. This is the semi-finals, and the score is currently 1-0 in Khaneesi's favor after winning as British against Russia. This is game number two. Lord Raphael, here he is, spawning in the north of the map in the color blue, playing as French. Two wood crates on the floor, they're going to gather them up, and that is most likely what he wants to see. Always nice to be able to get that trading post start as Russia. Going to be coming across 80 XP, probably not going to be going for that. By the looks of it, Explorer are going to be heading towards perhaps the trading post now that he's gone out into the black a little bit, has explored a bit of the map to find perhaps some things.
Yeah, I think he's going for, it almost looks like based on where the flag is, he's going for 30 food. Okay, there you go. But I'm so surprised he's not going to go crack shot that 90 wood and get started on it, right? Khaneesi already off to a better start, in my opinion, just from small things. He's already got an 85 wood under his belt, and he's free to scout the map. Looks like he is going for a TP himself, though. This is actually a really strong thing to do that people don't know about Aztec, where you can go basically fire pit and TP and just kind of build your market later on, and just have, with most says, you have a TP that's pretty good, right? So, why would it not be good here for Aztecs as well?
Yeah, kind of forego the market for the trading post. If you start with a 300 wood start, which is absolutely what he would have had based on his opponent's crates, yeah, fire pit and a trading post. That's a ton of XP, right? That's like having two trading posts from the start of the game, because that's what the fire pit is, really. It's like a 100 wood trading post. It acts about the same in terms of the XP it generates. But first shipment already. There it is going to be sending, I imagine, his three villages any second now. Yeah, I'm sure he'll do that. But yes, his opponent is playing as the Aztecs in the color red in the south of the map. This map is Manchuria. Let's turn off the fog of war and take a look around. French versus Aztecs, H2O. What do you think?
Oh, man. I'm thinking, I hope that Kanisi continues to path the way he's pathing, but turns out he's going to turn around and probably just scout the fog a little bit, maybe grab that 50 coin, then use it to go get the 60 food. Turns out to be not too bad for Lord Raphael, because he was a bit late on starting that 90 wood, and he really needs it. If you look at it, he's about to be housed, and he just finishes up that house right now.
Yeah.
100 wood landing in his bank, so.
Yeah. 300, certainly. Well, now he's got an extra 100 wood. What's he going
to
do with
that? Yeah, so I think he had a desperation chop because he wasn't because he was so late on the 90 wood.
Oh,
and he was
going to be
idle, so he had to chop. But he's walking straight away towards that cow and 50 food. And I guarantee you, Kanisi, if we toggle back over, is up at the 60 food, which is going to mean a pretty even split in H1. And look at this. Kanisi walking out here with a villager to get the cow and then eat the cow on the spot. I might be a couple seconds ahead of you, but he's definitely going to do that, my mistake.
where does this
I am end? Now caught up with you. It's in the it's by the water.
What?
Watch by the water. He sent a bill out there to eat that cow.
Huh. All right.
Which is interesting, right? I mean, he just doesn't have the time to scout it, so he goes out there, kills the cow, and slowly eats it to age up with as age up more quickly, I suppose.
Yeah, gonna get that age up in queue. Let's switch on over to Kanisi, actually. Yeah, well on the way. The messenger politician. So gonna be playing fairly aggressive for this one. By the looks of it. How's French going to deal with an aggressive Aztec, or at least one going up quickly with the messenger?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think Raphael's in a fine spot, considering they broke about even on the actual treasures, and then there's just nine cows sitting in Lord Raphael's face. I wouldn't even mind seeing him pen them and do something along those lines, but I've never even seen Kanisi not wall and play water, so this is just kind of odd to me to see three pills walking forward, right, to establish a base.
Yeah, that's interesting how you mention it. Kanisi, absolutely well known for his style of play. You know, the walls everywhere, playing the water when it's available, slamming down three docks and making absolutely tons of fishing ships if he can. There was a particular game, I believe, which I'll link in the chat. Oh, here we go. Crack shots the Mongol scout there. The thing is, though, is he going to be able to grab this scout there? He's going to get into hand combat with his explorer heading towards his base. Yeah, he could lose. No, he doesn't lose. It's going to retask on the explorer. I like that decision.
Yeah, I think what he needs to do is just punch with the Nave Scout and then run with the Nave Scout. Right now, he's going to get away for sure. Like, one of these two players, there we go, Raphael finally checking it out, and he's on his way out. He does see the work coming up real quickly, and if we look at the 200 wood he's got stockpiled, he's just started hunting ducks now, so I don't even know if he has placer mines, but it's just an odd amount of wood to have, 168 wood right now.
Yeah, you can spend that on steel traps and have a tiny bit left over, as in, well, like 50 wood left over, I suppose. It's not too good. But yeah, he has wood left over. It certainly will be useful. But yes, the war hut is up. Let's switch on over to Kanisi and see what he has incoming. Five coyote runners, of course, which he started shipping before this was up. Oh, okay. He's going to use the war hut to get this 80 XP. It turns out, though, when you attack the guardians, they'll retask.
Yeah, they retask.
Yep. So there is that. But five coyotes come out now. They're going to head on into the Lord Raphael's player's base. Might be able to pick up some villages. Let's see what happens here. But I want to continue my training.
Quick reaction there.
Yeah, gets that into the base. Not going to lose two more going to the base there. Plenty, all of them going in, actually. Going to sort of focus these down. Perhaps he will get one on the...
Yeah, he's definitely got one.
On the stable there.
And the stable not finishing either. That's just the difference between the stable finishing and not finishing is just so huge.
Yeah.
The amount of time that he's just stuck now, and that wasted a ton of time for Raphael.
Yeah, 12 villagers in the town center all that time as well, and they're still idle. A couple of them anyway. Look at them walking around, bumbling into each other, trying to get on this hunt there. Some being pulled off to build a house, but yeah, those coyotes I think fairly successful actually. Managed to kill a villager and. You know, create a lot of idle time. Certainly took some damage because Lord Raphael made a point of putting 10 villagers in the town center to maximize the damage that he could do. But here, yeah, is he going to come in and get another villager again? Looks like he's going to come in and cause some more problems. Is he going to cause all of them to be belled? No, going to turn around and shoot. Perhaps he's got... No, yeah, well...
Ooh. that animation cancel is nice. Cover moded coyotes to produce the damage. I'm almost positive they were cover moded for a second there. Not anymore. Mm-hmm. I almost thought they were. Maybe it was just the padding was weird, but you can cover mode those and reduce the TC damage, so that would have been really nice to see. A couple of HP builds here. Raphael smartly pulling those in right away. Geez, six Pumas coming to get on the house, and that's going to kind of keep his Hussars being useless, right? I mean, what can Lord Raphael do with three Hussar against six Puma?
He's going to have to send eight crossbows, right? I imagine that's going to be his next shipment. It is available now. I'll have to see what he does. But he's
TC just shooting at the Explorer, too. God, just he could have killed three pikes by now, but he hasn't. And Minutemen are coming now. This is a really good position for Raphael, though. Minutemen are going to pop up the back here, and they do get full bonus against Pikemen, which are kept, they are classified as a siege unit, which gives them that full bonus against gives the Minutemen full bonus, and cleaning up Kanisi really nicely here.
Yeah, shooting them, then kiting forward, really nice to see that. Trying to get as much damage in as possible whilst waiting for the reload animation. Does clean up the scout there, and saves his house as well. Not too damaged. I mean, he has been slowed down a bit in terms of by spending this wood. You know, it's all stacked up in his base. He's not able to spend that. He's going to have to replace a few houses because he is overpopped and, you know, lost some there. But fairly okay. He's managed to repel that pressure there. Has now used up his Minutemen. That is a valuable resource that has been used. And eight crossbowmen are just going to turn up as well. Give him a bit of extra security there. Though I'm not sure. Maybe he could have gotten away with an extra shipment. Be interesting. What are your thoughts on that?
I think it's okay. Sending the crossbow seems fine to me. He's going to send 700 gold now in age. I'm guaranteeing it. He's built a livestock pen. And, you know, rebuilding all his houses with his wood. You have to keep in mind how hard he won that fight. He killed 10 coyote and like, 5 puma, or 3 or 4 puma, and he didn't even lose a single hussar. He's got 2 that are pretty heavily damaged, but, I mean, that's just an amazing exchange versus the early Aztec pressure, right? Kanisi going for really inefficient shipments, like 5 coyote and 6 puma as his opening shipments. And, you know, he's going to come back in for round 2, but this is his final round, right? I mean, if he can't make a huge impact on Raphael here, he's not going to either. For us around the queue, if he can't do it now, he can't do it ever, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, looks like he's, and you know, he's going to come in. He must have heard you. Looks like he's going to push on into this player's base there. Has the crossbow and the Minutemen, and I guess the villagers. Has he got the upgrades on those? Yes, he's got the HP upgrade, certainly. Can he do any damage, though? Can he do enough damage? That is the question. House is going to go down pretty quick. Humans represent a huge amount of siege damage there. Cavalry do come out. That's going to be really nice for cleaning up things here. Pumas, though, very strong. His cavalry, almost brutally strong, but is hopefully going to get away. Looks like he's going to lose 2 cav there. And now those 2 remaining Hussars are kind of safe. These will be useful for cleaning up the Pumas a bit. Sorry, the Mishold. More Pumas do join the fray, but considering CDBs are so strong, I'm not sure if he's got this.
Yeah, and only 2 Puma left. Raphael pulling back his Hussar to raid still. I mean, while this has been going on, Raphael has killed several of Kinesi's builds. Kinesi's sitting on only 20 villagers, whereas Raphael at 19 CDB. So although this fight may look a bit ugly, I think, you know, the raids on the side have done quite well for Raphael. So, and he's going to pop out. He's going to market sell some food here and pop out a bunch of Hussar. I expect to see one more market sell yet for that one additional Hussar. And you can pair that with his back Hussar and just kind of kill all these mace right now. Yeah, there we go. And the 9 mace being the option that Kanisi goes for, not the best thing that you want to send here, right, against a bunch of Hussars, so.
That's true. Though it does have his opponent all penned up at the moment, though, inside that town center. 700 coin also on the floor there, not going to be collecting the rest of that for the time being. But yeah, Hussars, quite good against these. 3 Hussars on the way as well. Is it enough? Well, he's certainly penning him up.
It
doesn't
feel
like he has the remaining, the forces needed to, like, clear out the game.
Yeah, I think just as long as he doesn't lose any more CDB, I think when these 3 Hussar pop, we're going to see this will be backed off right here. And there, look at that. Look at how well those spread out right when they came out. That was really nice. Each one of them getting tasked on a different mace, going to be cleaning that up super effectively. And meanwhile, those 2 Puma are sitting in the back just sieging a house that doesn't really matter at this point in the game. I mean, look at they're both players are on like 20 population, so.
Yeah, warrior priests, 3 warrior priests do arrive for Kanisi there. They're going to get to work, I would imagine. Actually, they've been shipped to the war hut. Yeah, there they are. Going to have to walk all the way back, sadly. But Lord Raphael, keep calm, and has managed to stabilize with cavalry, which is hilarious because of the word stable and cavalry.
Yeah. So look at this, another catch coming up here on the left. So this is a big catch for Raphael, killing more units. And this is a really tough time for Aztec. They just don't have a way to deal with Hussar anymore, right? They don't have that big ball of units that they usually like to slam into Hussars. So I have this feeling he might just get picked apart by these seven Hussars while Raphael is going to essentially cow boom.
Yeah, and there's the recorded game playback. Finished. Game is over there. Yeah, look at it. He's got all of these cows in the back that you just mentioned. Just going to really, really stack up on the food really, really fast. Going to create a lot of units very quickly. He's almost got the wood for Arrax there, so he can add to his composition. And yeah, just managed to survive the aggression, the age up fast option, and all of the military shipments that Khaneesi chose to throw at him, and pulled out on the other side.
Yeah, wow. I actually want to look at the villager graph just to see how brutal this game was, right, for both players. I didn't get a chance to count how many villages Khaneesi lost, but looks like he lost three villagers on the side in raids and had a bit of idle time in there. Raphael, on the other hand, losing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 CDB. So both play and getting idle. Both players just, you know, one of those scrappy games where just there's just a ton of stuff flying everywhere, and looks like Raphael able to kind of pull out with a win there.
Yep, absolutely. But that does conclude game number 2. The score is 1-1. So this series shaping up. Next one coming up in just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back to the Winter Championships 2016. This is game number 3 in a best of 7 series between Lord Raphael and Khaneesi. This is the quarterfinals. The winner, or is it the semifinals? I'm not sure. No, it is the quarterfinals. The winner of this series will be eliminated. No, they won't. The winner of this series will progress to the grand finals.
So that would make this the semifinals.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
And the loser will be eliminated. I actually said the winner will be eliminated to start with.
I actually think we should leave this one. I like it. It's funny. Yeah, it's good. So
300 would start, though, for Lord Raphael. Pretty good for him. Going to lay down a trading post as British on this map. That is a curious decision. Let's switch on over to Khaneesi and see what Civi's playing. Japan. Does that tell us anything about his TP decision, H2A? What do you think?
I don't know. I'm glad you asked. I feel like the TP's just out of date. I mean, I like to see house market or double house. TP just isn't that great for British. Like, they already get all that. They get so much XP from building manors that they usually just chain together the first 3 colonial shipments anyway, right? I mean, usually you go 700 wood, 600 wood, 5 vil without almost any idle time in between at all. So that TP is going to be a long play for him, and maybe that is why he's opting to do it on a map like Siberia against a civ like Japan. You know, going for that longer, the TP will pay off in the longer haul, right? When he starts rolling in these shipments after those first 2 or 3 colonial ones.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, certainly a more short-term thing is the manners that, you know, this could build up over the course of time. It gives me, like, an inkling as to what he might be intending to do. Let's switch on over to Lord Raphael. Let's check his deck there, if he's selected it. Ah, no, he does not have the church card. For a moment there, I thought maybe against Japan, which has that sort of weak time, they're vulnerable to timings, aren't they? I thought perhaps that we might see an Azam-style Black Watch from the Advanced Church as a timing with Falconets, and you know, could be fairly effective against Japan. That is not going to happen at all, though. It cannot happen. There is no church card in this, but still, certainly maybe.
He does have the Scottish Highlanders, though, right? So he does have an option to get there without.
Yeah, he does.
How many Black Watch do you get? Like 8 for 1,000 food?
I think something like that. Another donation coming in. $2 from Zuta Zuta. Would be Mankle, and then I need to move this up so that I can actually read it. Oh, it's gone. I okay, well, at least the next one will be visible. But the game's...
I'll track that one down while we play.
Okay.
All right, yeah, I'll catch up. I mean, I'm a little bit ahead of you, but I'll keep up with it. He said I would beat Mankle in a jet mirror, no problem. So, thank you for that, Zuta. We'll have to do that one of these days.
Yeah, I'd like to see that.
Yeah. So, anyway, we're into this game. 90 wood coming out for Khaneesi. Already has one shrine down. Looks like he's about to get 2 more, possibly, off the 90 if he so chooses to chop a little bit extra wood. And Raphael just, you know, doing the same thing, right? He's aging up real fast with 16 vils, dumping them all into wood. This matchup is one where there's usually not too much action in age 1 just because both players want to be booming as hard as they can. And it's going to be interesting to see, you know, where Khaneesi manages to get his shrine set up, because if he starts setting shrines up, you know, way across the map and making it hard for Raphael to get on his hunts, then, you know, he'll be in a much stronger position than if they're just at his half of the map.
Yeah, looks like he's going to slam down the Age Up now. God, thank you. Going up with this to Shogu Shrine, nothing unusual here. Both the monks, though, are going to be going for this 205 food treasure for the time being. An excellent one for Punch-a-Pan to get because of the two explorers. They get lots of DPS coming out, and of course the Divine Strike, very, very potent on this particular treasure. So they're going to grab this, lots of food, and then I imagine, yes, we'll see the shrines coming down with the, you know, he's clearly very invested with that, with Heavenly Kami, the Portuguese Consulate, all of these normal things that Japan will do. Certainly could be seeing them on the front, as you're mentioning. That's the, you know, the ideal place, certainly on Japan. Switch on over to Lord Raphael and see what he has in mind. Of course, gotten up to the next stage, I mean, clicked up, and then switched all the villagers over to wood. The majority still on wood. Going to be slamming down those manor houses over the place. Looks like
aging with 500 food, I believe he's aging with 500 food.
Philosopher's Prince is definitely 500 food. What does that tell us then? Not a tower then. What's on his mind?
I think it tells us that he's going to boom really hard, because the only advantage you get from this is that 500 food allows you to chop more on wood. But at the same time, he's transitioning a bunch of bills to food and sending two proxy bills with 200 wood stacks. So I guess we're going to see a Rax right up at the edge of the ice here for Raphael. And I'm not sure what 500 food really means.
700 wood as his first shipment there. So clearly, still the standard way to play with British, you know, get lots of manors down and your infrastructure, perhaps, in addition to this barracks. But, yeah, forward for sort of barracks. Maybe looking for some more aggressive muskets, or maybe some pikes even. I don't know. We'll see what he does. It's not a defensive
I'm expecting pikes straight out the gate.
Yeah, especially with the 700 wood, right? Or perhaps are we going to see something Fortress Age orientated? You know, perhaps like a 10, a 5 pike, or even some muskets, sort of semi. And of course, sending 700 wood, as you know, because that's a very efficient shipment to get lots of manners out, maybe 700 gold. It seems like, you know, I'm saying that because of the trading pose. You know, not anticipating that's exactly what he'll do, as I find it still, as a British, would be rather unusual, possibly quite unlikely. But certainly something to think about. Another donation coming in, $2.30, Zootafruta Pro something player, boom to the Mew every sec Avil
boom,
Tech Shrine.
Boom, that's every sec Avil Tech Shrine. I have no idea what any of that even means.
We need to change the font color, please, so that I can actually read it. Make it black with like a white outline or something. Or white black with it. Yeah.
We'll fix it. I can watch too. I can see them pop in on my feed, right. So but I'll keep an eye on that. But anyway, with this, I don't really know. I feel like, to your point, the TP feels kind of misplaced here, right? I mean,
well, he's electing not to send that 700 coin that I'd mentioned. I would find that unusual. 600 wood does come out. Seems a lot more standard, right? You'd like to do that as well. Get the manners down, and that gives you a lot more XP because you built manners out of that and get the progression going. Pikes do come in and are going to deal some damage to the shrines. But yeah, it does feel a bit out of a place. Do you want to elaborate on that a bit?
I do, but I think more importantly, look at Kanisi is just starting his racks with 3 bills now. And I think he almost didn't expect this from Lord Raphael. I wish that, I mean, Lord Raphael's saying 5 pikes at the top, but look at the shrine density over here for Kanisi, right? All of the shrines are kind of co-located, so these pikes are going to be sieging non-stop, very efficient sieging coming out of these pikes. At the same time, Lord Raphael only has 80 house pop of his own, so he's been a little slow on the roll here with his boom.
Yeah, I'm going to switch him over to Lord Raphael. He's not aware of the density of the shrines, actually, and has got 5 pike over on this side of the map as well. I don't know why I'm flaring, it's not like you can see, but has got 5 pikes over there to siege, but he's not going to find anything else over there. So perhaps not taking the... obviously, Siberia is a very large map where you can distribute your shrines quite a lot. Hasn't done that, though, but yeah, he's only got 32 villages at this point. But, you know, he has spent... He could have a lot more villages had he spent that wood on, of course... on manners, but instead has elected to go for the trading sites plus the stagecoach upgrade, which is, you know, perhaps similar to the amount of economy that he could have generated there. 5 Yumi archers do come out. They're going to push these pikes away, and you know, the pikes perhaps going to see some more over here. They're going to join this other pikeman there, but those Yumi's going to catch up pretty quick, and he's going to need some reinforcing units to defend his pikeman there. Looks like he does have 4
every
long moments incoming.
Oh, every pike that even living with 1 HP is a big, it's just 100% different than dying.
Well, he gets away at exactly 6 HP. Yeah, nicely done there. And Longbowman joining in time to defend as well. I think by the 10-minute mark, he should be having a fairly good boom, which is about on par with what you'd expect from British, right? 4 villagers about to arrive, and that would indicate he's already sent 5. Yes, he has. So,
and he's got the coach upgrade too, and he's tossing it over to food and gold, wood and gold here. I'm wondering, is he planning to age right now? He might be. He might be looking for one more batch of longbow to pop his 700 gold, and then he might either be aging or cap. I'm not sure which one we're going to see. Probably age up. I like that, actually. I think it's a good adaption in the current meta. And all the while, look, he's been slowly working on this 300 coin treasure as well. So he's going to have all the resources he needs to age up without having to even mine.
Oh, wow. That's actually really, really nice. I can't see if the crack shot's ready, but either way, just one samurai left can go in there and finish that up. Yeah, 700 coin, plus the 305 there, and he's got a little bit of coin in base as well. This is really nice, yeah. The trading posts is now all making sense, right? It was all going to be part... Perhaps it's fairly similar to the market. We do have $2 coming in from Zuta Zuta. Victor Swee, you inspire me to be a better person. Coming in from possibly Zuta Zuta. He might not be, but
I think that was.
Yeah. Pikeman, though, is he going to get away?
Again, they get away.
Nicely done. Gets away
there. Pike's still alive.
Another donation, $2 from Maito. Streamers, I need to inform you that this game was decided by a coin flip, and Kanisi won.
I like that one. Kanisi always wins coin flips, doesn't he?
I don't understand.
It's a long story. We'll talk about it after the game, but... The coin flip is a joke about Kanisi versus Yumiu. So they decided the results of their game by flipping a coin because it was too laggy and neither one wanted to play.
Oh. So, all right.
Raphael letting the shrine finish. Is he gonna let it? Yeah, he is gonna let it finish. That's a shame. I guess it's okay. I mean, he does get an extra 35 wood from it at some point. Mm. You can use those pikes to kill the explorer, which is actually a really smart idea. Let's see if Kanisi poofs it in time, but. Killing that's going to leave all of his pikes alive and also prevent the reshrine. Ooh, aggroing this treasure though, killing the unit. I'm sorry, I'm bouncing all over the place. I know I'm
that's okay.
Just actually, watching them siege everything down.
The which treasure? 30%.
That one was the one he aggroed.
Oh.
But so, like, where are we now in this game? I feel like Raphael's got a significant lead because he hasn't lost a single pikeman yet. And, you know, 120 house pop for Kanisi is not a lot going into the Fortress Age. And, you know, Kanisi trying to just have a couple of Yumis parked by this TP. But meanwhile, the Ashi raid's going on, right? It's a little bit of a mixed bag here on what's going on in this game. I think it really depends on how many villas those Ashi are able to get.
Yeah, that's the question. $3.50 does come in from Zuta Zuta. He says, coin flip will decide the finals, question mark, or something like that. Everyone on stream saw it, but yeah, thank you from Mama Smurf, $2. Can Zuta Zuta and Victor Swee get a room, question mark.
They can, but only if they post about it in the donation shout-out box. So,
yeah.
We want the details of that one. So, he's halfway up right now, Lord Raphael, halfway aged up, and Kanisi sitting on, you know, a 7 bill shipment already coming in for him, just going to be trying to replace that economy that he's lost through having a lot of his shrines taken away from him.
Yeah, due to these pikemen running around, not actually being able to kill any of the pikemen, so keeping them alive. Really liking the build here, with the, of course, the trading light, the trading posts, Gipjuk bringing in all the resources. I really like all of that. He's now up to the Fortress Age with perhaps a significantly superior economy there. Does lose a few villages to these raiding, disciplined Ashigaris, but, of course, the longbow are going to clear that up. And we do have $2 from Zuta Zuta. We already got one, PogChamp. I'm surprised.
That wasn't the answer I was expecting. Those muskets are still killing vills. They got 3 vills from just 4 Ashi. Meanwhile, there's still 2 pikes up here sieging away on some houses. And it looks like Raphael's getting cleaned up by his trading post, and that's going to be taken away from him. So, interesting timing, right? Raphael at his weakest at this moment, just because it takes so long for the British to age up, right? So, really at a weak point for him. And,
so
I'm just going
to
be interested
though. I mean, so many shipments going away. Yeah, once they all start arriving, you know, he'll be back up to full power. But sadly, lost several longbowmen, as we can see here, and a trading post, which is quite significant considering it's aged up. This is not villages that he could have invested in instead. It's a trading post which is vulnerable and can die. And, you know, had those longbowmen lived and been combined with the 2 falconets that he has in queue, and of course the dragoons and all of the other units that he would be intending to make, would be in a very good spot. But sadly, the Red Japan player able to take out a few units before he gets to that point there. These musketeers in the back killed so many villagers. Manages to kill that last one before he dies. So much work being done down there. So pretty sad for him. What are we looking at? 59 villagers for Lord Raphael plus 2 working trading posts. Kanisi on 45 villages and 150 population with regards to his shrine. So I think that's actually fairly even, I'm tempted to say.
Yeah, I think so too. 5 Nagi coming in here on the side. Watch out for this. Like, it's a good thing that he was able to make goons beforehand. I think it's going to really nullify the effect of his five cap shipment. Can you see just fanning it out, sending one everywhere? Really hard to keep up with that with some of the issues in moving the units that you can see already. I mean, just one cap sitting on a house sieging, another cap running through the base. Raphael ransoming his explorer to build a town center too. I like Raphael's line of play much better this game. He's actually spending all of his resources. If you look at his bank, it's totally depleted in a similar way to Kinesi's. And really what I think it's going to come down to is just the player's ability to multitask here on some of these raids.
Yeah, lots of going on all at once. And it does manage to clean up the rest of these Naginata riders by the looks of it. You might want to pause your game. I'm not sure how ahead you are at the moment. But yep, okay, so... This is... Okay, Terry Orchard's coming out for Kinesi now. He's going to have to slow down a little bit because of that. Whereas the Lord Raphael player is going to continue to churn out lots of powerful shipments there. Picking himself up basically a whole card there. Increases infantry HP by 10%. Going to be really nice for him. But what's actually happening? Kinesi pushing forward with his army. They're going to be taking out this trading post here. Lots of units that are fairly perhaps out of position. But not as out of position as those Falconers. They feel very exposed in the middle of the map. They're going to be spotted!
Wow, he is just going for it. He's just manning up those chances. I like it. It's a bait. It's a big bait, I think. Oh, Kinesi knows it's a bait, though. Gets up, takes the free volley on, kills a quarter of a Falcon, walks off. That was smart of Kinesi not to get baited there.
Okay, so that was all intentional?
I don't think it was intentional, but I think it turned into a bait. Just because of the armor.
He still gets, still gets a nice shot off on there. Perhaps not as effective as shooting into a full... grouped up batch of units like that, but okay, so now we do see, you know, had Lord Raphael managed to keep those villagers alive earlier that were in the back there being beaten up by those ashy musketeers, he'd be in a very commanding lead right now. At the moment, you know, 50 points up and perhaps possibly a stronger economy, or at least equal to his opponent, has his two falconets out, which are always difficult for Japan to deal with, and now pushing forward with a really, really nice composition. A veteran longbowman now all upgraded, plenty of dragoons that he's managed to get out, and this is where, and look, he's going to be fighting in the trees as well. I think this is going to favor him.
I don't think those Yambusim are going to work at all, though.
No, even shooting the Yambusim with the cannons.
In hand attack mode. That was a huge win. Those things cost 100 gold apiece, right? That was 500 gold and 250 food right there. I wish Raphael was set up a little bit differently, though. Just up here on the top by the wonders, right? So that way he could be getting something that's actually threatening. Goons on the field, really nice for Raphael. Able to come back and pick up these small ashy raids as they happen, minimizing the damage from those.
Yep.
And, you know, just gotta be careful that when he's doing that, he doesn't get caught off guard by five Yabusame or five Naginata riders.
Speaking of them, there they are. He knows his dragoons are not in position, but they're probably on their way back, which they are. They're gonna get back there. Had they been trained, you know, 15 seconds earlier, or 10 seconds earlier, could have got some damage perhaps on that final foul that is about half HP. So that could have happened, but wow, you're clicking the keyboard distracted. You're also gonna say, come on, interjection, think. No, it's gone.
It's okay. Yabusame.
Does lose one volley to a market or something like that. It is going to come. It looks like he has... Oh, it was the culverin I was going to mention. Lord Raphael added in the culverin so that he can deal with the flaming arrow shipment, which has now arrived there. So really nicely timed. He knows exactly when that's going to be likely to turn up. Culverin now incoming, and that's exactly what he needs to deal with that. They're going to get back. Of course, Red does not know about the existence of the culverin here. Going to lure those, perhaps... flaming arrows out a bit, and then maybe shoot them down when he engages in a fight, of course, when he combines his next batch of units that come out. Okay, so, does lose the cannons, and lots of, I'm sorry if I keep missing these donations, thank you, $2 from Kinesi, since I streamed my map hack, everyone thinks I use map hack, but I was in just, it's gone now, I was just interested in something, so.
I was just interested about the program.
Oh, is that what it was?
Yeah.
Okay, he was just interested about the program. All right, Kinesi. But somebody clearly...
just trolling, the donation.
Impersonating him, yeah. But, still.
Raphael running out of hunts here, honestly, right? Look at the situation now. Like, the remaining hunts are quickly drained up, and this is where Japan really shines. Because typically, they send the berries, but they have a good amount of time left before they have to make that transition. And Kinesi floating 1,500 coin, we're about to see it, you know, either an industrial age or a huge influx of units. Either way, we're about to see something. And, catching that castle going up too. Definitely going to catch that castle.
Where's the castle?
It's coming by the gold mine.
Yeah. I see it. He's going to catch that?
No, the other one. Where the longbows are. Wish I could flare it. It's already caught.
Oh, yeah.
Right there. He caught 3 or 4 bills on that.
Okay.
It's hard without the players.
Yeah, your stream might be a little bit ahead as well, I'm not sure. I keep having, like, whenever someone actually picks up a treasure or gets, like, resources delivered to their trading post, I get super confused because they make the same noise.
That's true.
But you don't get that problem in an ordinary game, just in a recorded one here. It looks like he's on the right-hand side, though. Going to be pressuring up here near this town center. And
yeah, this is a much better angle for him, right? Look at all the valuable things there. Both the wonders are at risk. There's 5 shrines and a town center. Yeah. And Kanishi's remaining gold mines are also laying right out here. So, you know, Raphael has a huge advantage right now militarily, and,
I think Kanishi caught up in terms of economy, right? He's back to 200 shrine pop. Yeah, he just lost one, but still 200 population there. And, of course, 58 villages. That number going to continue to grow until he hits 75. We do have a fight here, though. The Culverins are going to be key in killing those flaming arrows. Look how much damage they're going to do to the grouped up longbow, but he needs to get a shot off on those. But looks like...
He will.
Okay.
He's totally fine.
Yeah, lots of longbow veteran longbow doing plenty of damage here. Plenty of dragoons, in the mix there. Not going to be too effective in this fight. There's not really any cavalry here, but certainly still needs them should any Naginatas turn up. Looks like the red player going to want to get back here, and the score differential getting... here comes the Naginatas going to join the fray, but I'm not sure how effective they're going to be against what is now veteran pikemen and a fairly decent stack of longbow in there.
Surely getting covered.
Dragoons.
Yeah, even if all the goons die here, the longbows themselves are able to clean it up. Yeah, and I think this might actually back, be really hard for Kanishi to pull through on. I think he's trying to get the longbow as well, but I just don't see how he's going to be able to pull through this. There's a lot of longbows still there. And Kanishi continuing to stream reinforcements. He's floating 2,000 gold. So, once again, imagine what he could have had. Right now he could have like 5 flaming arrows and just shoot what he's got.
If only there was a button that changed all your shrines.
Into flaming arrows?
Yeah. Food so that you wouldn't stack so much coin, but that is now you get it. Alright, well, yeah, plenty of coin. It doesn't have any mercenary shipments either in this deck in particular, or Japan generally, but so that's not one way he's going to be able to clean the coin up. Might be able to invest it all into flaming arrows. That might have been his plan all along. Certainly has the castle up available to do that, but, you know, we don't know what he's training, and Elected so far hasn't had 1,000 coin earlier, still hasn't made any anything like that. Anyway, at this point
like
in the game...
Looks like a huge Naginata transition is coming. He's teching Vet Nagi, he's sending 30% HP, and look, he's already got 10 of them out in the field, the veteran. That's actually enough where now it starts to get scary for the longbows, but look at that positioning all around the house.
Yeah, that was nice.
The Naginata's wasting their time trying to hunt down a single falcon and giving the longbows free reign here, and...
Yeah, so you'd like him to just slam down on there. But either way, still, right, he's got... He's got him on the back foot. He's going to be able to ship Minutemen there should he want to, and he's got so many units in this here. The cannons, though... the cannons go down, but as a result of that, not as much damage to the longbowmen as you were mentioning. Most of the cav are dead, and I feel like these blue longbowmen got a lot more value out than they otherwise normally would have. Cannons going to get hurt. Pikemen and certainly Dragoons joining the fray, though, so now safe from cavalry, but there aren't very many left, so perhaps a little bit late. Would have been nice to see them sooner, but of course you can always make them. Cannon does go down. Can he get the other one? He's not going to be out of the case.
There's just so many green right now on the field. Kanishi can just walk up there and do whatever he wants to that falconet.
He's going to have to get him. It's not like he can leave either. This guy's stuck. And he's kiting back with the cannon, which is interesting. Anyway, what are we looking at in terms of the score? Currently 65 to Kanishi, right, and all of the shrine pops, 200 population. Lord Raphael on 72 villages, so I think here, considering his opponent is 2 town centers up, what has happened is Kanishi's caught up in terms of economy and perhaps overtaken the blue player now, starting to increase the amount of reinforcements he can provide, and is perhaps going to slowly overwhelm British, push him back. Of course, we saw British sort of leading the game on the front, pushing this town center location, which I can't flare to H2O because it doesn't work like that. But now, switched back, it's now pushing Lord Raphael back across the map, and the comeback is starting.
And if you look at Lord Raphael's base, it just feels like a barren wasteland, right? And you look in there, there's a lot of line of sight, not a lot of resources, and there's no food, so he's already on 3 mills, he's on berries, he's got 1 coin mine left, one coin mine in the front as well, it's pretty vulnerable, and really just doesn't feel good to be in his position. Kanishi still has shrines up on hunts on his half of the map, and still tons of mines left, and as you mentioned, he did even get that second TC up. He's also sent cherry orchards again, so he's not going to have to mill for another, you know, 6 or 7 minutes at the very soonest.
Yep.
Meanwhile, Raphael's already dumped 1,600 wood into mills, and that's not even to count the cost of the upgrades.
Yeah, so you're clearly quite ahead here, especially since, as you mentioned, the cherry orchard shipments. The fact that you even have to build mills is... Oh, was that a donation? No, it was a treasure XP. It was a shipment.
TP pass, yeah.
I'm probably going to miss one. I'm going to get, like, habituated to the... Oh, no, that was one. $2 from Ryan Mankel. I only lost two games to Myo because Yuki is demanding much of me. Is that true? That would explain the losses.
Yeah, that just explains everything.
If you love me, you'll lose two games to Myo.
These trolls need to stop. We gotta focus on the games.
Yeah, well, they love Age of Empires 3, and they're funding the next tournament, so more power to them.
Yeah, I mean, if that's the way you want to... if that's your message of choice, then by all means, please do. But, we gotta keep focused on this game, because there's about to be a very key turning point. Either,
well,
wait, I guess it's gonna be...
Tell us.
I guess it's gonna be when he hits Industrial, right? Nisi's about to go Industrial, and... Raphael has no way of going Industrial for a long time.
Yeah, he's not going to have the resources available to do that, especially on mills. Very slow gather rates. Not sure what upgrades he has for that. But yeah, if his opponent gets up to the next stage, certainly he's going to eke out those... I heard that noise again. Going to eke out those Guard Longbowmen. Guard Yumi Archers, among other units. And of course, all of those really, really powerful ships. Villagers are going to get attacked here. Going to lose a few, but Sat certainly are going to get pushed back there safely by these disciplined Yumis. So not going to be too much of a problem here. Lord Raphael doing what he can, but there's a limited amount of time, right? The industrialization of Japan is incoming.
Yeah, and interesting to look at. He's even out of wood. Like, he's got his villas at the bottom of the map are even struggling to find a place to chop wood. There's going to be a lot of idle time there, and all this idle time and building of mills is translating into a free H4 for Kanisi here. Raphael does have quite a massive hussar, and these Yumi are out of position. If he's able to catch these, it would be huge. He's got to get up ahead of them, though, before they get to that gate, and I'm not sure he's going to make it.
If he can
no, there's the... going to make clubs are there, too. Free anti-cav.
And
gotta love Japan.
The Naginatas, yeah, he's safe. They're not as out of position as it
was. Six more clubs coming, too.
Oh, yeah, there they are. The club's very, very strong against the cavalry, of course. 14 times 5. Of course, there's still not that many clubs at the moment, because he doesn't see the ones joining the fight, but now they're here, really going to make a difference. He thought, there's only a couple of clubs. I'll just slam everything in. I've got some longbows in the back that I can pick them off with as well. But here, you know, opponent... is going to dispatch all these cavalry, and really that was his sort of lifeblood, wasn't it? And now that has disappeared. And his opponent up to Industrial Age as well. Let's switch on over to Kanisi and see what he has in store. Yeah, already more than halfway honored Yumi Archers.
And 4 flaming shipment.
Ooh, we do have
just
a
really
$2 donation from Jane Raidsaw. To be honest, I was distracting my O during the India game. All right.
Oh.
Well, there's that. What do you think of Guard Yumi Archers? Or Yuki Archers? No, never mind, it's not the same.
It was a good try. Yumi Archers are an insane unit. They're definitely Japan's best unit right now. Actually, not the best, but Yumi are incredibly good against Cav, just like Longbow, only without the setup animation, so they're even better. And I just don't see any way to ever break that giant ball right there. It would take easily 50 Hussar to clean that ball out right now, the way it stands.
Yeah, switching over to Lord Raphael, see if he's got some Hussar in queue. He's going about this in the right way, and of course has a Falconer in queue as well. That's actually going to be very good against the massive Longbowmen as well. But three Falconers, that is. But you know, he's got 48 villagers on wood, does Lord Raphael, and that's only because, you know, he'd rather have them on food, but you have to buy the resource locations to gather those resources that you want. If he could put those 50 villagers on the resources he actually needed, he'd be able to create more units and possibly be able to defend this here. But, you know, Kanisi already fully set up on all the resources that he requires, and isn't going to have to gather put all his villagers annoyingly on wood. Flaming Arrow is going to do huge damage to these Longbowmen by the looks of it. Not nearly enough Hussars to really do anything meaningful. Cannon does set up, but it's only one... Well, the three cannons, they're all set up. They're going to do good damage, but the Flaming Arrow is getting in close. They're going to be able to shoot them down. Five
yeah,
Flaming Arrows.
This has to spell a good game for Lord Raphael here. I don't see how he's ever bouncing back from this. And he's down in score, he's down in economy, down in tech, and down in army. So I think that will be called... He will call it right there a good game. 2-1 for Kanisi.
Lord Raphael does lose this match. The score is now 2-1 in Kinesi's favor. So we'll have to see how this shapes up. Does win this game as Japan. Let's head on out into the next one. unless you have anything to add.
No, nothing really. I'm ready to head to the next game. This one was pretty much just, you know, the two British-like civilizations just booming on Siberia and then fighting with longbow-type units. It was a pretty straightforward game, I think.
Yep. All right, what's the next map?
Next map, that is a fantastic question. Next map is Baja California, or as some people like to call it, Gaja California.
Yep, Gaja California.
Where
is my folder? All right.
All right, I am ready when you are.
People are saying this is a best of seven. Yes, it is a best of seven.
Correct.
But, yeah, so it's a best of seven, but we've made it spoiler-free if you don't know the games already, so looking at the recorded games won't actually give you any information. We've taken that into account. So
correct.
Basically what we're saying is there'd be seven games there, whether there were seven games or not, so no one can truly know. But, yeah... Obviously, we're not recording yet for the VOD. I can... Whoever... Yeah. Anyway. Yeah, let's get this ready. You ready to start?
Whenever you are. Let's go.
Alright. What was the time? 11:30. I'm wondering, should I crack open a Coke? I mean, I'm going to be up for quite a long time. Yeah, I will.
Alright. 2-minute break. I'll get some water. Coke sounds so good, though.
Delicious. We saw the amount of recorded maps, which gives it away a little. Nope, we took that into account as well. We renamed, or did we?
All right, I'm back whenever you're back.
Wow, interjection. Shameless product placement. Yeah, yeah. what's actually... The $450 we raised? No, that's actually Coca-Cola. They're funding me to place...
To advertise Coca-Cola?
Yeah, to place 200... To place Coca-Cola to 209 viewers.
Up to $484, so the small donations do add up, and we are moving our way up.
Up to how much, sorry?
$485.
Wow, almost $500 in one stream. That's incredible. Though I would like to, having dealt with PayPal before, actually a lot of that money will be lost to PayPal.
Some of it will, yeah, for sure. So.
Yeah, so,
but we're still, it's still going to go a long way to the tournament.
I mean, it's still a lot of money, but when we announced that
the adjusted
actually,
total,
the $450 donations wasn't $450. It's not admin fees. As some other tournament producers have put it, it's
the best.
All right, let's get this underway, and
yes.
Let's ban the finalists as well. You ready?
Yep, ready whenever you are.
3, 2, 1, let's go. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to game number four. No, three. Game number three in this. This is game number three, right?
Four.
Right, we're starting again. This is we don't need this. This is not live, therefore we can start again.
It's hard to keep in sync when it's on replays. It's weird, isn't it? It just feels different.
Yeah, it's annoying. I'd rather it be live, because then we get to use Azam's UI, which actually is really useful.
Oh, absolutely.
You can use that, apparently, for recorded games, but we couldn't for this, because they didn't use UI maps. They used ordinary maps, because they weren't anticipating playing live. What, can you see the... and it was on... What was it, Ian?
Baja.
Oh, that's it. Yeah, I know this. This is game four, yeah?
Yep.
Score is... Oh yeah, 2-1, of course. That would make sense because no one's won this game yet. Alright, 3-2-1. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to game number 4 in this best of 7 series between Kanisi and Lord Raphael for the Winter Championships 2016. This is the semi-finals, or semi-finals as I'd say in Britain. But yeah, the winner of this will be not eliminated, as I said in the previous one. Whoops. They all go through to the grand finals, and the loser will be eliminated. That is the person who will be eliminated here. Kanisi in the south of the map. Well, no, the left-hand side of the map. In the colour blue, playing as indeed the Portuguese. And that's nice, because it's Kanisi. We're going to see some... I really like this civilization selection from him. Of course, Port's quite strong on water. Kanisi, very good at playing on water. Kanisi has, in, like usually in his match. Games, the conditions where water is perhaps better. Not because it lacks, well, possibly, actually, that's a fair point. But never mind. And we do have, of course, a very closed map where walls are going to be very effective. So I can absolutely understand, perhaps, why Kanisi has opted to play Portuguese here. His opponent, yes. Lord Raphael, is also playing Portuguese by the looks of it there. So Port Mirror, going to be a lot of fun. And so far, we do have non-mirroring builds. Lord Raphael here electing to build a market and presumably get hunting dogs, whereas opponent has not done that, H2O.
Yeah, but unfortunately for him, he doesn't have 50 wood to start those yet. So he's found this 80 wood. Hopefully he gets it. It'd be quite a shame if this takes longer than expected and Kinesi's able to get up here and get on that, but I think he'll get it. And I wanted to say, like this, as you mentioned, this map is a great map for Kinesi's style in general. I feel like this map is like what Yucatan would be if it was a good map, right? I mean, it's got the water on either side, but the middle is just complete garbage, right? So the flow of the, it's got the TP line that runs down the middle, but it's not just straight down the middle. There's all these little things that make this just like a good version of Yucatan. But as we all know, that map is very very strong for water-based play because of the water on both sides. You know, you can start a fish boom on either side.
Yep.
You inherently have a TC near your side of the water, so you have an easier shot at defending your side of the water.
True.
And we'll see how all that plays out. We'll see if, you know, when players are sending schooners and what they decide to do.
Yep.
Raphael going straight away with economic theory, which is kind of an odd choice, right? It's a one villager shipment, essentially. And Kinesi may punish that by opting to go schooners first.
Yeah, he has done that by the looks of it. Kinesi well on the way with the schooner shipments. And this clearly tells us that he has a water agenda. No questions about that. But to be honest, did anyone have any questions about that? I don't think they did. Kinesi, 100%. Well, actually, no. During this series, we saw a game with water that he elected not to go with that. Maybe playing the mind games, perhaps.
It also has been the only game he's lost so far, so perhaps...
That's true. Maybe he should stick to his ordinary style, and that is certainly what he's doing here. Schooner's going to come out, going to reduce the cost of his fishing Vix boats down to 40 wood, and no doubt he's going to hit that age up. Almost at 800 food, going to click up there, and then switch everyone over to wood and start laying down docks and fishing ships and all of those things. On his opponent's side, Lord Raphael, as you mentioned, he has sent, of course, the Eco Theory, which you always neglect to state scales over time, because it does do that. But again, yes, you are right, as a one villager shipment, it's not particularly valuable, and perhaps you'll fall behind because of that. You know, schooner's certainly going to get more value out of that in the short term and the long term, perhaps, as well. But here, picking up 120 XP is Lord Raphael. We'll have to see what his agenda is. He's switching everyone over to wood, and I want to know what he has in store for us. There are water cards in his deck.
I'm expecting Stagecoach Boom, because he didn't send schooners, and he knows that his opponent is going to send schooners.
So he wants to play land.
Yeah, and so, obviously he's got to go Stagecoach here, otherwise he's going to lose the game for sure, because in the Port Mirror, usually there's this big window of time where both players are just kind of booming as hard as they can using any of the available means, right, whether it's docks, it's TPs, et cetera, et cetera. So if we don't see a Stagecoach build out of Raphael, then that Eco Theory is going to be a pretty large mistake for him.
Yeah.
And I already see the TP going down for Lord Raphael.
Yeah, it's already up now where I am in the game anyway. I know you're a little bit out of sync sometimes. I'm not actually sure where you're at. Going to pick up 30 coin as well to boot. Nice treasure to do that there. Let's switch on over to Kinesi. Yep, dock already gone down. There it is, and fishing boats already in.
And villager already crossing. I was going to mention this. I had a feeling he would do it. Villager already on the way across to build his second dock on his opponent's side of the water, because that's just what he does, right? He does this every game. And these are things that I would have liked to see Raphael punish more through studying, right? Like, just knowing that, well, I guess he still has a chance to punish it. When we see this dock go up, you can place your town center on top of it, right? Like, then what? Like, what happens if there's a town center on top of your dock that you've tried to proxy over here? You're just out 200 wood and every fishing boat you've
that's
built
a
on
fair
the size
point,
of
yeah.
the dock.
This style, actually, if you can definitely play to it, absolutely.
Yeah, there should be. I think instead, it almost looks like we're going for an aggressive land control. Right, look at where the TC is going down. He's building a racks. I think he's going to opt to ignore the water, which would have been fine if Kinesi was only on one side, but he's on both.
Yeah, and that's going to be tough, right? There's only a limited number of perhaps. Water ships, boats in your deck that you can use to really harass one side of. From a land point of view, it's easy to harass one side, but two, perhaps not. I do respect his decision to play a land agenda, though. Lord Raphael, probably, I'm not certain, but probably much better on land than he is on water. Khaneesi, Bonang, those are the names that come to mind and what are very well versed on that, where he practiced. But, you know, perhaps Lord Raphael knows that. Perhaps he doesn't want to have to deal with water. He want to stick to his strengths and what makes him feel confident. And that might be the land agenda here, which, by the looks of it, Trading Post Boom with an eco theory behind it. And, you know, if that's what he wants to do, if he's confident with that, we'll see how that works out. The question is, how effective will it be? And
it's a good question. By the way, that eco theory up to 1.6 villager shipment, I'll point out a couple more times. You'll be surprised at how late in the game it becomes a 3 villager shipment, and I think you'll feel, everyone in chat will feel the pain along with me on that one. But yeah. We also don't want to count Lord Raphael out, because if you remember in his series against Bonang, right, he brought a really, really solid game of Portuguese to Indonesia and beat Bonang at his own game. When Bonang was British with all the cards on his boats, he still managed to dismantle him and win the game. And he didn't do it by getting on the water super early. He did it by something along the lines of this. It was kind of a little bit of harassment, a little bit of map control, and then later on at the right moments, he asserted himself on the water and took Bonang's eco away. So still, I'm waiting to see Raphael show us how it's done on Baja California. He's already shown us Indonesia, so.
Yeah, we'll have to see. Well, you're expecting the same thing out of him then. That'll be interesting. I'm looking forward to this then. But you can see Khaneesi adding in walls behind walls now. He saw where the musketeers were, and as a result of that, it's going to just section off even more of the map there so that he's nice and safe. His village is going to be able to continue gathering resources. Despite the wall nerf in this patch, still going to be making full use of those and making sure his villagers can gather without having to spend resources on units for a long time. That villager is nice and safe. That does have to spend wood on a gate there, but probably worth it. That villager in the long term, certainly. But that gate is very awkwardly placed. Not often is it going to see use there, I would imagine, on that awkward side, but still, this is where he's going to start sieging, and with his musketeers there, and we'll have to see how much damage he can do. Yeah, another wall being added in behind that. Look at Khaneesi doing that. Yep.
Yeah, this wall is just going to continue to provide that control. I mean, there's no point even trying to push it at this point. Look at the Raphael side of the water, a dot coming down with 3 vils, but scouted by the native scout, so Khaneesi is going to be ready to adapt to that.
Oh, is that
and we already
go?
See instantaneously two caravels and a caravel in queue, right? So he is going to assert himself on the right side of the water, and unless there's an outpost coming up from Lord Raphael, this is just going to go horribly for him.
A caravel? I see no
tower. Check the queue. It's all in the queue I'm looking at. I went to Khaneesi to check the queue. He's got two caravel shipment, and he's got one training.
I see. I thought you meant Lord Raphael for some reason. I was like, oh, he's got his dock down. Is he really going to do that? No. Okay, so it's what side of the water? Where is this? Oh, it's in this dock here. So yeah, he wants to really, really push this up. Was that a reaction, training or shipping them to this side, and certainly training that caravel more to the point, because he saw these musketeers
leave
his opponent's base?
He saw the dock.
Oh, he saw the dock. That's what it is. Okay.
That was what triggered it for him. His native scout in position to scout it, and it turns out to be a huge advantage for him. Now, Raphael's got like one boat out there and a dock just sitting there, and I don't see how he's going to be able to take control of his own side of the water. He's probably surprised to see docks there, to be honest.
Yeah.
But he is about to go fortress, and Khaneesi obviously having trained two caravels, shipped two caravels, nowhere near ready to age.
He is up by about 16 villagers already, though.
Which is
then you got the 3 TP stagecoach. So really it's only 4, but I mean, it's going to be a lot more, right? Because now Khaneesi's taken ownership of both sides of the water, and he's got 4 docks up.
Yeah, plowing ahead and getting his long lines upgrade as well coming in. Looks like these 3 caravels going to clean up this dock and deny Lord Raphael any sort of presence on the water here. Completely deny that. Khaneesi going to be free to continue gathering resources on both sides, has them both locked down, one with a town center and one with 3 caravels. So we'll have to see what looks at that as well. We do see rendering plant coming in, so many fishing upgrades. This economy of Khaneesi going to get really, really far ahead. But Lord Raphael now up to the next age there, going to slam down an artillery foundry by the looks, but does have a frigate in queue. That's going to be arriving here. We're going to have to see, can Lord Raphael make use of this frigate, and of course all of the other fortress age men.
The answer to that's going to be no, for sure. That frigate's going to just get just absolutely dunked when it pops out, no matter which side he pops it out on.
Caravan's
I'm really
very,
disappointed
very
actually by this and the Culverin decision. Like, he's just over adapting to water in a way that he can't do. I mean, that Frigga's going to come out desynced from the culverins, and it's going to get surrounded by four caravels and just kind of own them. I mean, Khaneesi can retreat his damaged caravels and put them right back on the docks to heal, so he loses no resources.
He does have the surprise advantage, though, and he might be able to take out a whole caravel before they notice. No, I was hoping he'd be able to take that out before the special attack gets used. I'm going to micro this Vel back and perhaps going to lure that boat to... No, he's going to retask on this caravel now, but no doubt he's going to do the similar tricks, I would imagine. I love how the boats look when they get damaged here, but three caravels are no match for a frigate because of the special attacks, the broadside attacks that they get there. Going to retask on this boat, I would imagine. Yeah, going to pull it. Look at that. Khaneesi's boat micro, really well versed. He knows what he's doing there and just making that frigate go really... Where is it going? I'm not sure. Is it tough?
He's trying to... Ooh, culverins do get a full volley off and kill one.
Oh, I see. He's getting
caravel. And another caravel may go down.
Yeah.
I'm behind. I'm ahead of you. Sorry, crap.
Yeah, no problem. I can see why he was going towards the coast now, trying to get close to these culverins. The culverin's going to do really good there. The question is, does he really need two of them? It's going to allow him to push the water. It's going to make it very, very difficult for Khaneesi to assemble any sort of water presence if there are these two culverins nearby, because they'll just absolutely decimate any boat that pops out. But it feels like he's very, very heavily invested in these. And how useful are they going to be? There's two sides of water here, and Khaneesi's economy is already very, very far ahead of him. We know he sent all of those extra shipments, 65 villager population, and now a frigate in queue as well.
Yeah, way ahead. I mean, with the frigate in queue, right, where he's just going to keep, as we were mentioning, Khaneesi's just going to keep control of that water, and he's not going to lose either side, right? He's going to keep building boats on the right-hand side, and meanwhile, his own personal side is just, completely his. And what I'm really interested to see is, what are these P-Tarts going to do when they come out for Lord Raphael? Are they going to go fill the docks? There's four. Definitely going for a double dock snipe, and this actually is really smart. Spyglassing ahead of time. If he pops both these docks, all of a sudden Khaneesi's got nowhere to go, and the culverins and Frigga are going to be incredibly effective here. Already one dock going down.
Yeah,
right?
I really
or
like
about
this.
Sure. Second dock, is it going to go down? The second dock has to die here, and oh, it does go down.
Well, I can't see that just yet, but okay. Is it going to go down? Oh, yes, it does go down. Yeah.
And look at this, though. That's huge. I mean, Khaneesi's put all of his military investment into controlling this half of the water, and now he doesn't even have a dock down, so it's basically just a waiting game for Raphael to clean out all these ships.
It looks like he's going to slam another one down here. He really wants to get a dock up so he can effectively have a town center for these villages, for these fishing boats. They're going to provide covering fire against all of the boats. Very, very strong. Covering fire against everything. It looks like that is going to go up undetected there. But yeah, Culverin's going to sneak forwards. Looks like the frigate or the caravels, are they going to try and get a special volley off? I don't think they will. They're not going to do that. Looks like they're going to die to the two culverins, and actually now, two culverins looks very, very strong for Lord Raphael here. The issue is, though, he's on 48 villages, and Khaneesi is steamrolling at 70 villages. He has Rendering Plant active, he has Long Lines active, he has Gill Nets active, he has all of these upgrades active for his fishing ships. He's got a very, very strong economy. He's going to lose a few ships here, I suppose, going to even out that number a bit, but still very much ahead. Two frigates here. Lord Raphael has claimed this portion of the water back, but he's very heavily invested. And I'm not sure, Khaneesi would like this, but I'm not sure how effective it's going to be overall. Look how much economy he has, and just the rest of the map generally. Yes, he's dealt with here, but is it enough?
I think this is a huge deal. I think this is the start of a good thing for Lord Raphael, and he's about to do the same thing on the other side of the map. Unfortunately for him, he is going to have two frigs already invested in a way that he can't, he can't move. Unfortunately, you can't pack them up and move them over to the other side of the water. Right?
So. Not like a Falcon at the... Yeah, like IKEA boat doesn't work like that here.
The IKEA boat. Just stick these segments together and... But
he has locked down this section of the water, and these boats will keep it from Khaneesi gaining it back, so they do have that merit. Sadly he can't utilize them somewhere else. Frigate though is as you mentioned now on the other side down the bottom here, or as you mentioned about the water, that is, and a town center nearby. It looks like he's definitely going to win this fight against the frigate there, and of course another more P-Tards coming up to finish out this dock. Can he kill it before the frigate gets queued? No, but it's not going to happen. Oh, frigate does come out just in time.
Might not even be a bad thing, honestly. Look at this frigate from Khaneesi on the bottom half is under. They're duking it out, and multiple fronts are in the water. And interestingly enough, I feel like Raphael's in a good spot. What we want to check now is the villager count, not the boat count. I want the vill count. So I'm checking Khaneesi at 51 and Lord Raphael at 69. he is up by 18 bills, and those are the bills that count, because ultimately, you know, both, if they split the water, both players can get on a couple whales, sure, but there's only three whales. I mean,
yeah.
You got Stagecoach in the mix, too. I would argue Raphael's ahead economically, despite being down in villager count by 14. I'm surprised he's still even got boats that are able to gather, honestly, on the other side. There's three. There's actually seven on the other side gathering that are basically dead, so.
Yeah, they're on this, yeah.
Wow, but Kinesi's setting up another dock.
Is he? Yeah, he really wants to claim this back, I suppose. He's going to... I'm still looking at Kinesi. I don't know how much... He's got quite a lot of villages on wood and gold. And, you know, he's going to try... And he's got, I suppose, the Carronade upgrade coming in. His boats are going to be very strong, of course. And, pardon me, he's going to be able to perhaps try and reclaim this back. You know, two frigates here with a town center support. The dock is still up, you know, being rebuilt. He's still... trying to force control on that side here. Now that Lord Raphael is, you know, investing resources in the other side, it's this is really, I really like this, battling on both sides. You never usually get to see this.
Yeah, and I think Raphael may be the new, like, go-to, like, the new guy for water. He's been doing a lot of, great things here in both this and the other game I saw him play on water. He's getting out here on the map right now. His frigs haven't had the time to regen, unfortunately, so repair themselves, and they don't have the same upgrades as Kinesi's right now, but he did clean out a bunch of fishing boats, and there is still that one culverin just poking away at him. Hopefully he doesn't lose one of these frigates at this point, but
yeah.
Oh, they're both so low.
Yeah, they are.
Raphael needs a couple more docks so he can do a little bit of parallel repairing here.
Yeah, culverin incoming though, and that's going to be very influential in this fight. That definitely wants to keep an eye on these frigates, definitely does not want to lose them. They represent, oh, look at that villager in hand combat as well, and the frigate gonna retask on that. He's gonna have to get back now because they are very low on HP, and obviously they can be repaired at the dock if they just sit there idle. They can get their health back. He does not want to lose a single unit there. I like how that villager just comes out to help clean up that culver in there with, you know, doing that 10 extra damage is really, really meaningful. Especially with their multipliers. Oh no, that's just for ranged actually. But yeah, the boat as well, now gonna repair, as you can see, at this dock. Let's check the other dock here. More boats. But Kinesi has his own culverin here, so it looks like on the south area, Kinesi has, you know, full control of this area, and especially with that culverin being added in. And I'm not so certain about Lord Raphael's dominance on the north half. A second dock being added in, of course, this is going to double the healing rate on these boats now. And I think only one boat can be repaired at a time, so he needs two docks.
He just blew up a couple more docks.
Yeah.
The P-charted down one and did half damage to another. But those P-charts don't, they're not cost effective. It's, you know, 200 wood, 100 food to kill a 200 wood dock. So it's not terrible. It's 100 food each time. But really, you want that to be, like, the first time that surprise went through, it was really, really sloppy of Lord Raphael to let that dock get down up there at the top. And he's still paying the price for it, right?
Yeah. No land conflict except this. Which you can't really see. Just a couple of minute men dealing with some cascadors. Just all the resources are being invested into water fights here. And that would make sense. Because the longer this game goes on, eventually the fish will run out, and Lord Raphael is investing in those land upgrades, such as Economic Theory, by the way, which is now worth
up to eight
villages. And is a 10% upgrade you could never actually get. Based if you know, compared to your opponent, because he can't actually send it. Once you're at 99 villages, that's 10 extra villages your opponent can never have, I suppose, by sending that. Perhaps, you know, it's only good in this circumstance where you anticipate the game going all the way to 99 villages. Otherwise, your point absolutely stands. It's never going to pay off. But also, let's take a look at the other shipments.
The Industrial Age pop. Wait. Industrial Age
Wait, what?
Kinesi.
Really? For Kinesi?
So, Raphael's close to aging up himself, but... Just he's been sitting right on the cusp of being able to age up, and Kinesi, meanwhile, has actually finished it up. He's got two monitors in queue, and I'm wondering, those have to be on the top half of the map.
Yeah.
On the top half, Kinesi is just gonna totally take control of the water with that. Stealth Native Scout even giving him vision of the docks and the ships to special shot.
More petards coming in. And he's got plenty of culverins here as well. Yeah, I'm not too... Well, his dominance here is coming back. I wasn't certain, you know, because Carronade had came in for Kinesi, and these boats are going to be very, very strong as a result of that. These come out, the monitors, these are going to do so much damage with their special attacks there. It is nerfed on this patch, but, oh, it does still take out almost all of those culverins, and that is going to prevent anything from getting hit. And I think, yeah, what Kinesi wants to do, and he's been demonstrating... Not Kinesi, Lord Raphael, he's been demonstrating this a lot, is to just blow all the docks up in a single sweep, because... if you can just get rid of all of them, you stop him from training any new boats, which cost a lot of resources and take a long time to train. So I can see why he's doing that, but as you mentioned, not cost effective. He is up to the industrial age as well, but not before, you know, he gets his opponent gets there first and managed to kill all his culverins as a result of that.
Yeah, and I think those culverins, the two culverins were a miracle how much value they got, but now at this point, culverins I think are just been wasting resources, and Kinesis translated those into an industrial age advancement and two monitors, right? So at this point, Lord Raphael's about to lose his entire, he's going to lose all the presence on water, and in this map in particular, you need to hold one of the sides for sure, and yeah. I don't know how he's going to be able to do that unless he gets a full, yeah, I mean he can, because the other thing is, Kinesis smartly leaving this frigate alive on the bottom half, if you look at it, no one cares that there's a frigate on the bottom half. Like,
yeah,
just,
and
no
that
one
keeps
cares.
His build limit low, doesn't it?
Yep, and that's meanwhile, Kinesi actually fed his frigate into the towers, and he's probably going to remake it on the north half of the map. This is one of those times where what you need to see from Raphael almost is a hard switch to the other side of the map for his water.
Yeah, because you know, you see Kinesi fully invested on the north there, two monitors, two frigates, and they're not going to, you can't like move them, as you mentioned earlier, so if suddenly switching will nullify all of the resources invested up here, I suppose, if you continue to fight. Now, I think the interesting thing here is, you know, they're both up to the next stage, they're both getting their factories out here. The fish are going to run out soon, I think, very, very soon, actually. There's really not that much, actually, there's a few patches left with 500 in. Perhaps it won't run out for a while. I guess, actually, 500 is not that much food when you consider there's 400 in a pronghorn, so actually really not very much food left at all. And take a look at the reason I mentioned this earlier, eco theory, but also royal mint, refrigeration, all of these late game upgrades that Kinesi I don't think has sent.
No, he hasn't sent those.
He sent fishing upgrades certainly, but when the fish run out, not going to be useful anymore. And then suddenly, you know, very even scores, but Kinesi has Lord Raphael, 97 villager population, none of which is boats, more of which are upgraded. That eco theory is really going to start paying dividends in the late portion of the game. But the question is he going to get there? I mean, he's losing a lot of ground on this water here now that these monitors have come out. Culverins are going to find it very, very difficult to get close as a result of the long-range offshore attack that the mortars provide. They can blitz mortars in a single shot. But yeah, can he get to that point? And if he does, he's in a good spot. But he has to get there to start making these long-term, really, really long-term, you know, we're talking about eco theory at the start of the game, really, really long-term upgrades to start being useful to him in a very meaningful way. Can he get there?
Yeah, and I'm not sure he will, honestly. If you look at the water situation, he's invested so much into trying to hold this position on water when really he could have been investing into a rotato over the other side, right? He needed to rotate way sooner. And it's like there's just so many resources floated from both players. There's so much opportunity here, but I feel like this is one of those situations where Kinesi's going to get to catch up just because of the chaos created on water. Yeah. And you know, economically, Lord Raphael, as you mentioned, way ahead here, right? He's going to be able to send a second factory, and he's got cards in. He's maxed vills. Kinesi's several vills away from max right now. Like, he's got 84 vill count, and he's got like 20 in the queue. Yeah. So, you know, a long way to go for him. Because remember, the vill limit also counts vills in the queue. So he's actually 1, 2. He's actually 8 less than that. He's only got 76 vills right now to Raphael's 99. Yeah. That's land vills, remember. So there are fishing boats, sure, but still, their fishing boats are not real vills.
Really useful, yeah, especially in the long portion when the fish run out. Culverins do come in here. I'm not sure if the long range offshore. Yeah, is it? You know, it's used on the dock by the looks of it. So these boats going to be able to push these culverins going to push the blue boats back.
Yeah, and I think, what does Kinesi have left? I'm looking at what he's got left. He's replacing his frigates. He's got one frigate left, one mortar, one monitor, and a lot of towers. Also worth noting, maybe one mortar would have done so well here, but...
That's true. Mortars definitely better than culverins now at this point for countering boats.
Yeah. And Kinesi actually sent this card called Team Coastal Defense, which gives your towers 100 more damage per fire. Yeah. It gives them one additional multiplier on the anti-ship attack. Doubling the effectiveness of the tower, actually. So,
it's worth pointing out now that players have gotten to this point in the game, have surplus resources running around. We do have like Janit Dragoons just running around the map, causing chaos. We do have a donation coming in from Zuta Zuta, and before it goes away, can I read it, please? It says, "This one is for Pencil Power. Your beautiful child, keep on being you." All right.
Okay.
Well, there's that. So, thank you for the $2, Zuta Zuta. Eco Theory arriving for Kinesi now. Oh, I suddenly see why Eco Theory is not good, because you can just send it at this point in the game.
Yeah, there you go. You came to that realization all on your own. That's perfect. So Casey's up to 111 bills. He's actually going over the bill limit with the boat, which is nice. It's just, I feel like there's so much missed opportunity here from Raphael to just say he had given up the water on his side and just made a full hard transition to their side. I don't know what Kanisi could have done about it, but, you know, both on land and water. But at this point, like I mentioned, this is one of those games where Kanisi's been given all the time because of this weird water fight on the right, and he's totally been able to catch up economically.
Score's very even, though. And worth pointing out, which I guess Kanisi does have refrigeration in his deck, so he can transition to that. And he does have, by the looks of it, a sustainable agriculture as well, so he's got that for the late game portion.
Yeah, but he is missing, as you mentioned, he's missing textile mills, world mint, sustainable agriculture. Does he have that? He's also probably missing arsenal upgrades. Also worth noting, Raphael did build an arsenal, and Kanisi has not built one yet. I don't know, I think. I can't find it by hotkeying to it. What are the range on his goons?
Lord Raphael has one.
18. Kanisi doesn't even have an arsenal, so he could get like heated shot for the towers, and, you know, obviously that additional 2 goon range that we all know we can get from the arsenal. Yep. He doesn't have any of that in. So still another timing window for Raphael to use those techs too.
Yeah. 108 vills, obviously counting fishing ship. He's getting it back to 99 here. The water. If he's got... Oh, we do have $2 from Zuta Zuta. This one's for Zoe. Hashtag land grab.
Hashtag land grab.
What a great card.
And another donation. 2 more donations.
Yeah.
Coming in here.
Ooh, another one. Geros Katsaros. For the $11.13, he says, thank you, guys. Gero Castros is somebody I've known on ESO for a long time. Thank you. No problem. We enjoy doing this. Thank you for supporting ESOC. And then, another donation. $2 from Diarrhea. Diarrhea. Mankel, you got lucky today, he says.
That's a troll name for Dioroga from our series earlier today, so... goon-on-goon action right in the middle of the map here. Looks like Raphael's goons both outranging and outnumbering Kanisi. So this is what we're talking about, that efficiency there of having the advanced range and also just superior resources. And
360 HP and 41 ranged attack compared to 35 and 320. That's so much higher.
The scary thing, though, is are those monitors going to be able to hit these factories? I don't think so now, but
yeah,
Kanisi will show us.
I was concerned about that. Now that
training
he's lost
2 galleons, too. I think he's going to build some units on the coast and just troll with them, maybe? Or maybe just use them to get a fuller water army on the side there.
Yeah, I was thinking, you know, now that you... I was going to mention that once you've trained all the caravels, all the frigates, and all the monitors, maybe galleons is the next logical progression in terms of having water army without having to send cars that are increase the build limits there. So perhaps that maybe they are, you know, they can be, they're gonna deny these docks here. They can be used as barracks, as you mentioned. So perhaps we will see Janit's being trained
on
those.
We do. Whoa, look how fast those hussars are coming out.
He's got
you actually are 10 seconds behind. I'll pause it. I'm
$2 from Zuta Zuta. Jim Leem, you're the wind beneath my wings. Sorry, the wind beneath my wings. Thank you very much for the $2 Zuta Zuta. Wow, they are very, very fast. You are right.
Look at how fast those are coming. Look at the cavalry training. You can tell Kanisi's done this before. I'm taking notes on this for next.
Wow, that is...
Holy shit.
Why is he got, how is he doing it? He's got, of course, riding school, mass cavalry from the church, and that's it.
And,
oh no, he's got,
yeah,
what's this,
takes,
Navajo settlement. Did he get anything from there?
No, he doesn't have anything tech from that. That's not... It just... That's how fast those are trained when you have those two techs.
Oh wow, okay, that's very fast. Yeah, and look at that, just going to rush in here and cause so many problems for all of the villagers on the mills and that, and on the plantations. Just going to kill a lot of them, I would imagine, or at least idle them if he bells, causing the dragoons to be pulled back here to defend. And yes, he's going to be able to defend here. He's going to defend it fairly easily, but we have to remember those galleons, they're on the water, and what is the water? Nigh untouchable, because Kanisi has won that fight on the water and secured it, it's going to be very difficult to get back. And now, constantly, unless he can get a wall up, there's going to be Janice and dragoons and all of these things just running around his base, and over the course of time, this is really going to screw with Lord Raphael's resource incoming. You can already see that coin is getting dangerously low. No, that's wrong. Lord Raphael. His food is dangerously low for Lord Raphael. He's not going to be able to sustain unit production, especially if he can't gather. And
he's lost so many bills, too, and it does take time to replenish those, even with 4 TCs.
Yeah.
This is like a huge turn in the favor of Kanisi here, because now, even though he's lost a bunch of resources here, he's bought himself more time on his own front door.
And he's got Raphael to scramble to keep his bills alive. And
ooh, we do have $2 from Zoo. Hashtag basement screw shout out. Basement crew shout out.
God. Should probably skip the next one. I'm going to read out loud. That doesn't seem too appropriate for the stream. But,
And
yeah.
We do have $2 from Yuki. I am pregnant. I love your father, Mankle. You're a father, Mankle. Oh, God. This is just full-on water cheese, isn't it, at this point?
Yeah, at this point, I mean, there's just a constant flood of goons coming out of that galleon.
$5 from Xanon10. Zuta owes me a reply. Star, star, star.
A replay analysis.
Oh, replay analysis. Oh, it's because I had the word anal in it. That'd be why.
Yeah.
Alright. This is really bad for him right now. Down to 83 villages, and was Kinesi on 112. So probably maxed out on 99 vills and has these galleons working away from constant units flowing into his base. And over the course of time, this is now an attrition war, isn't it? Because, and I think Kinesi's going to win that because of the amount of damage he did to the villages.
Yeah, at the same time, he is now at this point being inefficient because there is a there's a turning point at which...
Look at that. I love these sovereigns.
Doing nothing?
Well, no, they're going to try and kill the galleons. He needs to get rid of them.
Oh, that's true, I guess. I didn't even think about that. I was going to say, there's this turning point where eventually... Ooh, that galleon's low, too. There's a turning point at which you should start feeding units in for not enough economic damage for it to matter. And Raphael, very smartly recognizing how important it is to get his bill count back up, is still training more bills. But four Hussars are snuck in the base for him. And he's also doing some raiding of his own on Kinesi's front. So both players are losing a couple of bills here.
Yeah, it's... Yeah, Kinesi, doing a... I really like that though. The boats do go down. He's gonna.
Oh God!
What's up?
I know what's gonna happen right now. This is about to be terrible. Look down at the bottom of the map. Look at where there's an attempt at building an artillery foundry by Kinesi.
Oh, I see. How is he gonna get a villager in there?
It doesn't. I mean, he may or may not get it there, but he looks like he's gonna walk all around. And if Raphael does not react to this, look at where his factories are, and those are irreplaceable imaginary builds, right? So like, they don't take up population space, and they give you a huge boost. So. When you lose the factories in the late game, the Age of Empires 3, you've kind of lost.
Yeah, well, at this point in the game anyway, where you've got maxed out villages and things like that, and as I mentioned, War of Attrition, it's just who can make your opponent run out of resources first, and who has the larger bank of resources to sustain a just constant...
Look at Raphael's vision. Look at Raphael's vision. You can't see it. And look at the score. I mean, this game, Kinesi has spent so many units in uselessly here that Raphael is, at this point, in a commanding lead, I would argue. Except
Whoa, really?
For the fact that...
He was like, oh, we do have a $20 donation from Gaming Violinist. Thought I should jump on the bandwagon again. Hashtag Cash Wars. Sponsored by Crude Oil. Because, of course, Sander is from Norway. Thank you very much, Gaming Violence. That brings you up to $120, $19 above good speed. So, good job there. You're now in the lead. And there is that.
These mortars are about to get in the lead here when five of them pop out and kill yeah. everything. That this like these are the game-winning mortars. I'm almost certain of it. Just from watching, there's zero response from Raphael. He's clearly just missed it. I don't think he's even thinking along these lines. Once again, this is very much Kinesi's space, is this late game battle, and I think, you know, a more experienced player in the late game would have seen those bills and thought, holy shit, my factories are there, I could lose the game right now. These genites are terribly out of position, mortars so close to popping out.
Switch over to Kinesi and see what yeah, five mortars here they are coming out. And these represent like, well, 7.15 villages. This is like, you know, 10 villages, maybe more, considering the terrible gather rates on plantations that only yeah. don't get that much better even when upgraded. Yeah, gonna lose these, and just the amount of resources and therefore reinforcements he's gonna be able to make goes down drastically. Also loses a lot of flexibility in terms of what resources he needs, because you know, factories give you the ability to gather resources out of nowhere. You can just switch them instantly. They don't require you to have a mill or a plantation built. Prerequisite requirement that is to start gathering that resource. It doesn't have them anymore. $21 from Zuta Zuta. Did someone say Cash Wars? Question mark. Oh, thank you so much, Zuta.
Thank you so much.
So much money coming in for the tournament there. We really appreciate that. But actually, Gaming Violinist donated 100 earlier. So, sadly... Unless
you have a ways
to
go, Zuta. We gotta add up your $2 donations.
Yeah.
But I think you still got a ways to go. Look, these mortars are setting up, and I think they're in range of the other factory. And here goes. This is gonna be a second factory for Lord Raphael. And if you notice, he's up by 100 score. His bank is massive.
he did such a good job of handling those raids, he was probably going to be back up at full build count and going Imperial.
Yeah.
But now he's probably lost just because, I mean, two factories is 20 builds, right? You're just out 20 builds, you can never get those back. And I don't see how you recover from that as Lord Raphael.
We have to remember, Lord Raphael does have a textile mill. He has refrigeration, Royal Mint, refrigeration,
true.
All of these things. We do have $2 from Fighting Frenchman, gaming violinist, composed the podcast theme song. He did do that. Big shout out to him as well, and all of the money he's providing. What an excellent musician. He's also going to have doing the War Chiefs on a violin cover, which I'll be publishing on my channel as well. $22 from Gaming Violinist. Bring it on, Zuta, he says.
With a $22 donation. I think we've got the wealthy Age of Empires players busting out their money here, laying on the table, seeing who can donate the most.
This would be great. Maybe we'll get to the $100,000 tournament. We can top what I think was called War Is Coming, Age of Empires 2 scene, pull the 100K tournament out. Maybe one day Age of Empires 3 will top it if these guys keep it up. I doubt that.
We just need 100,000 more donations,
yeah.
Or 10,000 more donations
true.
From Zuta.
Yeah. But okay, so he's lost his two factories. That's terrible for him. If he kept that, he'd be in a very commanding spot. Look at the amount of resources he has. Far more. This is, if we look now in the bottom left of the resource, I'm going to switch over to Khaleesi. Khaleesi has far less, right? So Lord Raphael in a really strong position. We do have $46 from Zuta coming in. Okay, your move, he says.
Wow,
Zuta, the generosity is strong today. That's a lot of money, dude.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. It's awesome to see the community turning out here. Yeah, so what they call this a tree, now we're moving into tree, so we may as well start.
Okay, we need to go fetch the tree.
At this point, what you call it as Khaleesi is either you're draining or I think it's called draining. I call it starving out sometimes too, but generally people, if you flood units in on an aggressive front, usually you're not too efficient with them, and if you run out of your bank, then you're drained and you can't stay at 200 pop anymore. And that was Khaleesi's position. He's still in that position. Lord Raphael with such a large bank, if he just got out on the map with some mortars, he could still win this game. He just needs to leave where he is and get out there and do something.
And the reason I pointed out earlier, the refrigeration, Royal Mint, all of these upgrades, that, you know, textile mills, all of that, is perhaps that is enough to mitigate the fact that he's lost his factories. If he still had those, and you know, you just mentioned he has a very large bank, consider the position he'd be in with the ability to generate resources. Maybe those upgrades that, of course, Khaleesi does not have in his deck will be enough to
hold it off. Yeah, just buy him the time. I see what you're saying. That's going to buy him the time to, you know, the factory loss isn't going to hurt him immediately. He'll have a little bit of time here to use that bank. And if he gets out there, like you said, and uses it, he'll be in a great spot. Just as long as Khaleesi can't keep him on the run, he'll be good.
And he needs to repair this wall as well. But to be fair, what's the point if the galleons arrive again? Oh, we do have $2 from Fighting Frenchman. Hippie name is fired, Herbert, and I'm a Bales Bondman. Alright. Thank you for the $2. Though I don't understand your message, I'm very, very sorry. But a big dragoon brawl in the middle. Lord Raphael has the ability to sustain this, whereas Khaleesi, I don't think, does. Only 500 food there, he's not got the flexibility to keep pouring dragoons into this war, and you can see that the in terms of attrition, Lord Raphael's score creeping ahead. And that
Raphael needs to be fighting, like you're saying. I mean, every second he's standing around is just giving Khaleesi time to establish that lead with the factories, and I just don't like it. 115 bills and the factories versus just 99, or 88 even. Like, why is Lord Raphael not just constantly fighting right now with all of his units? He's got like 20 idle dragoons down here in the bottom.
Perhaps he's waiting for another batch and then he wants to head on in. But yes, you're right, he does need to keep the pressure up. Let's compare their stats here. Okay, identical unit stats, so nothing important there. I thought maybe an extra upgrade that somebody had might be coming into play. Okay, so in terms of units here, there are 32 blue dragoons. Let's switch over to Lord Raphael, and we see 32 red dragoons. So this is a very even fight, actually. It's all about eking out as much value as you can, and not overkilling anything in particular, making sure you're using your explorer here, that Lord Raphael is, of course, that thing has the ability to instantly kill a unit in the Industrial Age. That's a crack shot that a lot of people will forget about because you don't actually get to use it very often. Lord Raphael, 1.5k food, insta-training dragoons, well, not instantly, but you know what I mean, very fast. Khaleesi, his bank is going back up. He's not had to replace as many units. Looks like, there's plenty of dragoons. What do we have here? $2 from Yuki. He says, I also like Prinz, but Mankel just better in AoE, and that's what's important about him, man.
Yep. Anyway, so these goons are still sitting down here. These goons, no, the fort's going up, and those goons that I was talking about earlier still haven't gotten in the fray. It's 20 population worth of units, and Raphael needs to be pushing his population advantage because he certainly doesn't have an economic one. He's down, like I said, 89 villas, 115, two factories. And now there's a fort up in the mix just slamming cannonballs at these goons. And I'm sure there's Navajo, champion Navajo in here, which is a nice adaption by him, but really, we need to start seeing some mortars come out. Look at the bottom of that, Khaneesi's still just continuing to put on all these different angles of late game pressure. One mortar coming out of a 50 HP artillery foundry, and that's going to get a market, or a mill.
Yeah, I like how it is just one mortar as well. Doesn't want to use up too much population on siege units that aren't going to be fighting in this. You know, the more units you have, the faster you can drain your opponent out because of the sort of exponential effect. Only needs one mortar to run around dealing siege damage here. I really like, you know, that these units. Lord Raphael, his bank is still growing relative to Khaneesi's. Yeah, you can see he's broke. And I think, you know, as I mentioned earlier, those upgrades that are in Lord Raphael's deck that he has so much he has working for him, I think that those might be enough to mitigate the fact that he lost his factory. Here, though, one random mortar, if he's still at his factory, he's in a great spot. This one mortar is going to go down as well, and killing off the mills, I like this, because at this point, he's got plenty of wood, actually, but maybe he thought Khaneesi thought Lord Raphael didn't have very much wood and find it difficult to replace these economic buildings, especially since he lost his factories. But we do have $2 here from Fighting Frenchman. Is Alt-D cheating? Yes, it is. But we do have lots of Dragoons for Lord Raphael. He's managed to get this mass up higher than
I'm totally on board with you. There's no way he's going to... Do you think he's going to be able to remaster? I don't see how he's going to be able to do it. I mean, he's only at 140 pop with not a lot of resources in the bank. His mills are vulnerable and the Hussar are up there raiding him. Like,
look at the desperation as well. Just randomly sending shipments that he didn't beforehand because... You know, he's just like, oh, I need more stuff. Two organ guns are going to pop out on a terrible side. They're going to get destroyed. But this is what I mean. When I keep saying attrition war, I mean, who's going to run out of resources first? Who can eke out the value over a very long period of time and just win by attrition?
And I feel like the only hope Khaneesi has at this point is to create enough chaos where the game isn't ended by him being starved. And it's going to be so hard for him to do that, though. I fully expect to see as well.
I didn't see his message, but go ahead.
I keep messing up the recording of the song "Feels Bad," man. # shameless promotion. And
he's been trying to make that for a while. Every time he gets a note wrong, he has to re-record the whole thing. So I can see that being great. He's violent.
Check out Raphael's bass when we're talking.
Oh god, Hussar's incoming again. I see what he's doing. This is so cheeky, isn't it?
And that's what he needs, though. Raphael needs to get the walls up, and Khaneesi needs to keep the chaos rolling, because he is fucking broke right now.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, this game is absolutely ridiculous at this point. Yeah, deleting some of his dragoons just to free up space back home for population. That's like treaty style, what's going on here. You'd never delete units, and even in treaty, you'd never want to do it, unless you absolutely have to. These random Hussars coming out.
Hussar roll up.
Yeah, in your base out of nowhere. Really making use of those galleons. Really nice to see that in play in a supremacy game. You never get to see this kind of play. But yeah, you said it so perfectly. Chaos is exactly what Khaneesi needs, because he's absolutely out of resources, you know, no good at all, and he's not going to be able to continue to create units here. He needs to make a distraction, cause Lord Raphael to run back home or something like that. And even at that, if he's going to get back in this game, he needs to even out the villager population, but that's almost impossible to do, I suppose.
Back to Khaneesi's base, because now this is the moment we were talking about. Sure, he's created some chaos, but he is pretty broke. He can't keep affording to do that. And meanwhile, 30 goons have gotten past his front line, and that's
the resource he needs most.
Yeah, and let's mouse over Khaneesi's villager count. He's at 75 vills, Lord Raphael, and a 72 villagers, right? So, actually, Khaneesi had even less because he's got some in the queue. So, their land villager count is exactly equal, and then Khaneesi just no bank. So, Raphael floating even 5k wood, which at any point in time, he can honestly just re-macro that. 5k wood is a lot of wood, but... He's gonna have, you know, Navajo and goons flooding in here, and Khaneesi calling Colonial Militia at this point to try to hold? I don't think that's gonna be enough to stop Jedi Dragoons.
No, they're actually very weak at this point. Minutemen, like, don't get stronger over time relative to the other units that get upgraded there, but, yeah, they are, They're not going to be useful. Like, this one-time shipment that's much better for timings, if your name is Azam, in earlier portions of the game. This is a very different game now. This is no longer the Age of Empires 3 of used to. This has moved into this late treaty-style portion of the map. And I know when we say it's like treaty, all the treaty players are just face-palming because it's absolutely nothing like treaty in their minds. But to us, supremacy
is
scrubs.
No, this totally is it? Except for the water. Except for the lack... Except normally they don't plan maps with water, but... The dynamics that matter here, things like killing factories, things like keep getting a bunch of raid, getting a bunch of damage off on a villager, or using a single mortar to slowly push up on something, starving out. Kinesi is like the textbook definition of drained. Like, he just drained himself, and he's at 120 pop now with no... He's done. I mean, I don't see how he can win. I'm sure treaty players over here feel like this game is incredibly over as well. Just, I mean, look at this. Kinesi's villas are all flooding, are all like moving back into the corners.
Look
and
at
he's
the
hoping to survive.
Lord Raphael's bank is now, you know, 3k food, 6k wood,
yep,
3k
he's gonna go
gold. Through. Let's compare that to Kinesi. Yeah, he's broke. He's got plenty of coin, but it's very, very difficult to change the, like, it's not a case of just retasking the coin villages to something. It's, you actually need to have the production facility. You need to have mills. He does have mills, but of course he can't get to them. You need mills to actually gather the food, so his situation's not going to change.
And I'd be kicking myself if I was Kinesi right now, because you killed your opponent's factories and you won water super hard and you still lost. Like, you still lost. Like, that's just gotta feel terrible. This mortar coming in here is not gonna die. Kinesi's trying to focus it down, knowing how critical it is to keep that factory up, but he's just feeding castors into that. And I almost feel like Kinesi's gotta be trying to accept defeat here, as this mortar just continually firing shells. Needs two more shells, and I don't think it'll get both. I think it's only gonna get one. It's gonna be close.
Let's see. Oh yeah, because you're a little further ahead, I think. Navajo Rifleman coming in, and it's going to get them. I like the introduction of natives as well. Why are these being trained as opposed to Casadors?
Because they don't take population space.
Oh yeah, of course. He needs
that. That's why Raphael's training them. I don't know why Kinesi's training them. I don't think he should be training them.
Maybe he doesn't. Well, they'd be veteran Casadors. Perhaps you know, these are fully upgraded champion Navajo Riflemen. Perhaps that's why.
He does have guard Casadors.
Oh, he does have guard Casador. Okay, so it should be Casadors.
Yeah, exactly. But remember, we were talking about also the efficiency of fights and why you drain. Like, you also drain when you're fighting at 170 pop versus someone who's maxed, right? And he's just not getting a rest from fighting. You can't fight when you're down 30 military population. We all know that in supremacy, you lose that one fight, you lose the game. But here, it's just, like, it's, instead of that, you're just draining really fast. And that's what's happening to Kinesi right now, right? He just cannot get back up to maxed.
Yeah, Lord Raphael, because his opponent isn't providing... isn't able to counter drain him as much, I suppose. Look at that, 5k food, 3k gold.
Going Imperial soon. I mean,
6k wood. Yeah, if he gets to Imperial, that's... Like, even if Kinesi pushes him back somehow, which I don't think he's going to be able to do, getting Imperial, which he has the resources to do, is... Oh, we do have $2.50 from Bernie Sanders. 1% of the ESOP community have 89% of the wealth. That's so, I can see
political.
Why you'd use the name Bernie Sanders for that. Okay, the joke, the political joke is acknowledged. But,
Even a crossbow coming out here and just getting obliterated. I mean, Kinesi is, and you'll notice, food counts the same, coin counts dropping, which is just an indicator of Kinesi trying to rebalance, but just not being able to do it. I mean, there's just, he cannot stabilize, and he can't be standing here fighting these goons, honestly. He really just needed to back off, like, you know, 4 or 5 minutes ago.
Well, if he does that, though, the walls get sieged down, and then the remaining everything else just ends up dying, I think.
Yeah, what he really just needed, though, like, this entire time, was just to fall back.
$2 from Zuta Zuta. This one for Matt. Hashtag crank debt soldier boy. Matt referring to soldier.
Yeah. I like that one.
Yeah,
like always, Zuta Zuta, always with the clever donations.
Yeah. That's good.
We can't forget that, though. I mean, at any point, he had a huge economic situation, but then also your upgrade card, so maybe he didn't. I have a feeling when we see all resources gather, it's going to be a decisive lead for Raphael all throughout the game, which may even change some people's views about water in general, right? I mean...
Yeah, possibly. Yeah, that's true. I mean, at this point in the game, which has been going on for a long time, what is the water really giving him? Like maybe a couple of extra bills on gold, and that's about it. That's why he has so much gold, isn't it? Which he can't spend, just because of the whales. But as I was mentioning about the Imperial Age, which I believe he will be... Has he got in queue now? No, but he's almost there, right? He could sell a lot of that wood if he wanted to, but probably... I don't know, we'll see what happens. The point is, though, even if he did get pushed back, if Lord Raphael got pushed back all the way to his base, maybe some random Chaos Hussars appear out of nowhere, if he got to Imperial Age, those upgrades... Imperial Janik Dragoons are disgustingly strong. I am Soldier with the $2 per, whatever it is, donation. He says, YOLO! YOLO.
No, he said you.
Oh, he says you. Sorry, I was,
I think we see the nail in the coffin coming in pretty soon here.
Yeah, I think so too. And especially with this Imperial Age stuff I'm mentioning as well. You know,
look up at the top, by the top blue trading post. So there's a couple of units up there. There's something up there. He's seen it, so he knows 20 bills are up there and food totally open and exposed.
Yeah,
and that might
be his lifeblood at this point. All of the droplets of food that these two that the mills are making are funding the dragoon pot production on the front lines here. And suddenly, if this is, you know, which he can't defend, it disappears. He's going to find himself in a very, very tough spot. I imagine reinforcing units are going to end up in this location here. Even if he doesn't kill the villagers, just denying this location where there are two mills is very big. Yep.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, really, just the continued story of Kinesi running out of resources. He's now his mill count's dropping. He's still at 135. Then Raphael just miles ahead at this point. Already on his way to Imperial real soon.
Recorded game playback has finished. That was a game. I mean, towards the end it did get rather samey, I suppose, but actually what was perhaps arguably samey was actually, in my opinion, like really interesting sort of combat moving all over the map. Hussars coming out of the galleons, moving the combat back towards his base. I really like the mortars that you were mentioning that Lord Raphael didn't notice and killed the two factories. You can clearly see how experienced Kinesi is as a player in these sort of situations. He's able to do these things that seem rather cheesy, but actually are just parts of the game that most people don't get to experience. $2 from I Am Grunt, and then some Korean message, some Korean graphemes that I'm unable to decipher. So thank you, I Am Grunt, for the $2 there. And then towards the end, and $2 from the Mammosmurth. Really fitting to see Water Game being casted by the Water Boy himself, Kappa.
Awesome.
Yeah. Let's finish talking about this game and get on out of this one.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's move on to the next game, probably. If you look at all resources together real quick, Kinesi did outgather Lord Raphael by quite a bit. Military population tells the other half of the story. Raphael always doubled the military population of Kinesi. Basically, just watch Kinesi's line spasm up and down.
Yeah. Well, it's consistently high.
Raphael's consistently high. Yeah. Exactly. And that's, you know, you can gather all the resources you want, but if you can't win the fights, that's really.
Yeah, and the fact that all of these units are high means he's not going to lose units as much, and he's going to cause his opponent to lose units faster, which then affects the drain and this war of attrition that we're talking about. But Kinesi, a well-versed player, but Lord Raphael ekes out the victory.
Get a new King of Water for Lord Raphael? He's taken down both of the big water players in water-based matchups.
I really love this game. Like the boat fighting in the early game, it's so refreshing to see it so different. And I think only Kinesi can provide that. It's such a shame that his connection is complete BS. It's so laggy when you play against or with Kinesi. But that's unfortunate. But an interesting game, and certainly something you don't get to see too often. A 45-minute... industrial age brawl with Janik Dragoons, which are of course very, very strong. 20 range on that after you send a cavalry, genitors. But that does conclude game number 4. The score is now 2-2 in nobody's favor. I'll be right back.
Nobody's favor.
It is 2-2, right?
Yes, you're correct.
That was the longest game I've ever casted. Ever. I guarantee that is the longest game ever casted. Because
with the delay as well.
The reason it was, it was a 44-minute game. That's not the longest game that's ever been casted. But the fact that it was a recorded game, where the playback is just slower than real time for some reason, just makes it just stupid. Like, wow, that was it wasn't actually that bad, but I think it was so long. But I did like that game. I quite enjoyed that.
Yeah, that was good. I thought all the games in the series have been pretty good, except for that first one. That first one was kind of just meh to me, I feel like Raphael really misplayed.
Yeah. And again, thank you so much to all of the money that has been contributed so far. Do you want to give us an update on what that is?
Yeah, so we're up to $640.
Holy shit! And oh my lord, that is huge.
I need to start looking through my analytics to just, I want to find a way on this thing to show top donors, and I'm pretty sure I can somewhere. I just need to figure out where. So we can get a couple of people listed up here for their contributions.
Yeah, I think a news post needs to be put out on the ESOC after, if someone's in charge of that. I don't know who does that, but just a list all the people that I think that'd be a really nice thing to do, because that's so much. $640 is, who gave 600? Nobody gave 600. Well, the community did. Collectively, we have raised $640. Notably, I believe something like nearly $200 came from, of that, came from Gaming Violinist. I imagine like 100, maybe more, maybe came from Zooter, 100 from Goodspeed, and just so many people chipping in random $2 donations. Yeah, like people like Frenchman is going to be really quite high now as a result of all of the $10 and $5 he's been chucking in here and there.
And guys, remember your messages. I just pulled the donations from the page, and I've exported them. So the name that you use is the name that's going to be used for totaling. So if you start tossing out troll names back and forth, you know, like if you use a different name each time, then I won't be able to tell you how much you've donated. But if you don't do that, you know, you do it the normal way.
$2 from Zuta. Zuta, he says 642 onwards and upwards. Oh wow. Yeah, do you have, if you open OBS and then set your bitrate to 1 and just preview stream, you'll get a notification every time I do?
Oh, I have set Twitch alerts open.
Oh,
and
do you?
Live
okay. Oh, you can actually read them physically.
Well, yeah, I can read them. They stay up there forever. That's how I've been doing it.
Oh, nice. Okay, well, that's even better. You don't have to run a stream.
Yeah, so you do that. You get ready for the next game, and I'm going to very quickly just pop these into a chart so I can see who's donating.
All right, let's take a quick break before the next one, though. I mean, like a minute or so, or maybe 2 minutes. It's just, it's...
Pause the overlay up, and we'll take a 3-minute break.
Are you sure? We can just talk to everyone whilst we're here.
Yeah, that's fine. I didn't know if you were going to, like, go somewhere.
No, I'm not going anywhere. I just want a quick break before we jump into anything.
All right. I'll save as to the desktop. Donations.
Sorry, I just see Donald Trump for president, and the next comment is taunt 2.
Taunt 2.
Yeah. Sorry, I just thought that was like the promptness of that was amusing to me. It's just some guy's like, so Age of Empires 3 ified his opinion.
Alright, we got the name, and we got the amount. We got the sum of the amount. We got the name, the color. Toss the amount up there.
What if Donald Trump actually donated $1 million to ESOC? Well, if anyone donated $100 to ESOC, I'd be, $1 million. Sorry, not 100, a million. I'd be rather amazed. But I, as much as I'd love to, I'm not going to talk about politics. Religion and politics are the two. Don't talk about those on screen.
Correct. There's a couple of topics you just don't want to delve into. Mm. So let's do. All right, I officially have a chart for us. And do we want to do just the? Actually, we also want to put a number on there.
Interjection hates Hispanics. Confirmed. Well, I live in the UK. Like, Hispanics have nothing to do with my life ever. And actually, I'm actually pro-left wing, but I just want to, before people interpret what I was saying about it, anyway, I don't want to talk about politics. That is going to be the last comment on it, and I would like the moderators to, I don't know.
Discipline people heavily for this. All right, so I have now a donations dashboard set up, which I will be sending you screenshots occasionally to share with everyone.
Okay, I'm hoping left and right wing, by the way, means the same thing in the UK as it does in the States.
I think there was one point in time when they were actually backwards. At this point, right wing is very conservative, and left wing is like most of Europe and America.
Okay. Thank you, Fighting Frenchman, for the $5. You can read that one out because it's so long, and I don't want to strain my eyes looking at this white text.
Yeah, sure. Give me a second to get back to my dashboard. $5. Let's dispel once and for all this fiction that H2O doesn't know what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. H2O is undertaking a systematic effort to change this forum to make ESOC more like the rest of the internet. And that's a quote from Marco Rubio, I believe, about Obama, with my name replaced with Obama's. So that would be a political donation.
Yeah, that's amazing.
All right, let's hide this title. And then I have one other thing, we'll add a filter. The top donors list is going to be cut off at $10, and I'm going to change that amount based on the level of game that people bring to the table, right? So if we end up, if the donations gets higher, then we'll have to start filtering more people out.
I always play to win. $2 from Sompu.
Nice. Sompu always playing to win. I like it.
I know in the US, never mind, let's not have this discussion.
We can have that discussion on a personal conversation.
Well, it wasn't anything really politically related. I will say what I'm going to say, because it's not. It's like, I think at one point, where in the UK, the left-wing government is represented by the colour red, and the right-wing government's represented by the colour blue. But in the States, I believe that's reversed.
Ah, yeah, see, the colour red is conservative or right-wing in the US for sure.
Yeah, whereas red is very much the left-wing colour in this country. Well, actually, green is the even more left-wing colour, but they're not taken as seriously, I think. But, again, I think this is not the place to be making statements, like, qualitative statements, like, taken as seriously, so... But as a general consensus, I suppose. Right, now, even I'm breaking the rules. I need to be banned in the chat.
Yeah, ban interjection in the chat, please.
Yeah.
All right, I just sent you a picture of top donors, and I can update that after each game.
Should we...
It's in Skype. So you may want to open Skype on our screen, right, and then pop that picture up, and you can pull it over. We obviously will have something live set up in the future, but this is just
Where is this thing? Oh, I see. Oh no, how did you do that so quickly? That's pretty cool.
So I exported it all to Excel, and then made a I connected that to Tableau and just made a Tableau chart real quick.
Is that right? I think Gaming Violinist has donated 142.
Perhaps the names are different. I will have to check.
Yeah.
Let me find
this is a very rough and ready sort of top donor. It's interesting. So
yeah, so that's
so
the only one
people.
Gaming. Ooh, violinist. I think there's some misspellings going on here for Gaming Violinist.
Thing is, though, with your method of names, people can artificially inflate other people if they wanted to. People could all donate under the name Yuki. And push that up in the charts.
There's no way to prevent that, though.
No, maybe that's a strategic way to.
And look, Gaming Violinist is up there. He's number one and number whatever. I'll fix that right now because there's one little typo on one of his donations. Mm. I'll just manually fix it. And yeah, we can make this way fast. I can do this way faster if we have it automated, right? So, all right, there we go.
Yep.
I will send you one more thing.
All right, we'll get this image, then we'll do the total so far, and then we'll get to the next game.
Yeah. And I will update this again after game.
142 to Gaming Violinist. $101 to Goodspeed, $67 to Zuta. You need to send two more Zuta, that'd be perfect. Jerem is 50, Purple Squid is 50, I Will Spank You is 30. And we have another one coming in, $2 from Multiplex. Good cast, let's see the next one. Absolutely, we'll get into the next one in just a moment. And where was I? 11.1 from Gaia, 11.1 from Geros Castros, 10 from Martins Dave. I believe this 11.1 must be European dollars. Because they must have.
I think it's a conversion.
Yeah, the conversion to Freedom Dollars is favorable by the looks of it. Martin's Dave, $10. Sir Callan AOE, $10. Whisker Baskets, $10. And plenty of other people with the random $2 here and there. There'll be a complete list on the either a forum post or the news post. I'd love to credit some of these people for their generosity because we basically funded a whole tournament in a single stream. And
we're doing great here, guys.
Really, really proud of the community. Thank you so much to everyone who's donated. We were, well, I think I think H2O, I think generally ESOC was worried that there wouldn't be a spring championships. We'd just wait until summer because there wouldn't be enough money for it. But absolutely, there certainly will be one as a result of the generosity. How much are we so far?
Let's see. Quick F5 of my page tells me we're up to 660. So another $20 or so has rolled in a couple of small donations while we were doing that totaling. And yeah, I mean, I expect to see it'll go up a little bit more. We still have one or two more games. Is that right? It's 3-5 right now, or is it 2-2? It's 2-2 right
it's
now.
It's
2-2,
so potentially
three more games at most coming here.
Yeah. All right. Well, that will be fun. So I'm going to quickly run to the loo real quick, and then we'll get into the next one, right?
All right, I will continue. Maybe we continue analyzing your city when we left off.
Maybe I should give you a different city to analyze.
Mm-hmm.
I won't. I'll be right back.
No, no, yeah, come back. Hmm. I'm still waiting to see that juggler. Where do you think he's going to bust out and start juggling now? Looks like we got a couple people going into the town hall. This is like a pretty boring time. That fisherman is still there, though. I mean, at this rate, he is never going to feed his family, right? If he just keeps fishing like that. And, wow, he gets up and he must have heard me. He's out of there. He's walking further down the dock, though, behind the menu. So I don't know what he's planning here, but I'm pretty sure it's not where you take your fish when you're done with them. Hmm. Yeah, he's just walking off screen, I guess. I don't know. I guess he's just taking his fish and he's going to, you know, walk straight out to sea with him. I like how Interjection knew, like, actually took the time to customize the city, too. Yeah, like, he's got flags in there, and I'm sure a ton of these buildings aren't default. I know that I'm looking at my German city on my monitor right now, and it just looks like a barren wasteland of just, like, a few buildings. Certainly don't have any jugglers or any town drunks walking around, or any carts of goods. People are walking around trying to sell their goods. That fisherman just walked back, and he's sitting down again. I think that guy's just trolling us. I don't think he's even fishing. I think he's just sitting there with the pole out.
All right, I am back.
All right, I just went on a rant about how that fisherman, he got up, walked off screen towards the water, and then came back and sat back down. Like, I think he's just trolling us. I don't even think
yeah,
he's that.
The movements are odd. They like they go in very odd places and do silly things. I need to update this city. Let's get on multiplayer and let's get this city updated, shall we?
Get us one new city for the next time.
Oh,
and then we'll
have Ooh, we do have $4.50 from Fighting Frenchman.
And
I donated more than $10. I demand to be on the list. I think that's actually true. Fighting Frenchman absolutely has.
And Zuda donated $37, demanding a recount on his on the totals. I'm gonna go pull it again. Remember, guys, I will spend more time vetting this. You literally just watched me pull an Excel sheet and make a chart in 2 minutes, so I did zero validation on that. Obviously, when we do post the results, it will be accurate, and you will be reflected accurately. Up to $700 total, actually.
Holy
crap. $699.69. So if someone wants to break the number of 69s in there and push us over 700,
$16 from Zuda
Zuda. Zuda Zuda Classic.
Continuing the funding from Zuda Zuda Classic. This guy is a generous guy. Yeah. Oh, look, even a Nightbot is plugging the link. So someone's gotten on there. All right, let's interjection hacked confirm. That's a good point. I better check. I couldn't get in. I just gave up in the end. I don't know what my password is. Oh, it's working. All right, let's go to my city and customize. Look at that. Right. So I can unlock all of these things, but you can't always. I think I've unlocked everything. Yeah, I think I have. Yeah, I unlocked everything and I've already chosen it. Oh, okay, let's actually do something meaningful. Let's go. Let's play.
Well, you're doing that. I'm very quickly updating donations, so.
Alright.
My Excel's so fucked up.
Ooh, 269 from Multiplex X999. I think you found the way to build good cash price. Oh, where's it gone?
I'll read it for you. But first, can we get the game? We gotta get the game started. I need you to help me get this game started.
Alright, let's get this started. Can you read out that guy's message before we begin?
Yeah, last guy's message. I think you found the way to build good cash prizes. That's great. I love this game, and big thanks to you guys.
Yeah.
I'm hoping so. I mean, this is actually really exciting for us. You know, one of the biggest things holding back having more events is obviously funding. The game's pretty small community. We're very tight-knit, so it's good to see everyone coming together.
Wait, this is real money? Sorry, Mom. $4.50 coming from Zua.
Gaming violinist with $20. Not this time, Zuda Kappa.
Yeah,
looks like they're going to continue waging it out. You know what? I'm not going to update. You guys have to keep track in your head. We're going to start this game up here, and after this game, I will update the totals. So there is no intermediate wins here unless you're counting them in your head.
What's
the next
that?
Total will be after the game. Let's see. We've done so many. What's left?
It's 1:40 in the Norway. Please start the game. All right, let's get under this. What is it?
It's Bengal, I believe, but I think we've done 5 games now, right? I feel like we've done 5 games. They've been so long. I need to check what we've done.
Yeah, we have. We did. It's 2-2, isn't it? No.
No, we've done 5 games, though. Right. I think it's...
We played on...
Yeah, we've done 5... No, Hudson Bay. We haven't done Hudson Bay yet.
We played on California. We played on Siberia. We played on Manchuria. We played on Pampas Sierras. Yeah, we did. We haven't played on Yukon. Ooh, what the fuck? Oh, wow. Okay, $100 coming in from Zuta Zuta. I hope this isn't the money you were hoping to fund Battle Royale with. I was really looking forward to that, and I would love to see that go ahead. But seriously,
we can't retotal yet. I know he's trying to make us, but can't retotal until after the next game because we spent so much time.
Yeah.
Well, these guys going at it here on the donations.
Oh wow!
Thank you so much, both of you guys and everyone, obviously. But
I'm dumbfounded. I wish that was $102 because then it would have beaten the. Oh no! Yeah, if it was $102, it would have beaten Goodspeed in a single donation. But it can't go back on that. Okay, so we haven't played Yukon. We have done Pampas. We have done Manchuria. We have done Siberia. We have done Baja California.
Hudson Bay
and Bengal, right? Other.
Yeah, it's Hudson, then Bengal,
and
then
Yukon.
Yukon.
Yeah, okay.
So do Hudson now.
All right. Oh, $2 from Iron Soldier. It's contagious. Hashtag love. It is contagious. Thank you very much, Soldier. We appreciate that, and this stream has been nuts. I can't believe it. Why wasn't this enabled before? I don't know.
Yeah, interjection just out of the blue says, "Hey, you know what a good idea would be is having some donation possible through the chat." And here we are donating.
Yeah,
through the chat.
Went all right. We spent 20 minutes on it this morning, and
setting it up. Yeah.
Funded a whole tournament off it. I can't wait. I'm so happy about this. This is great. Big community crowdfunding for Age of Empires 3 tournaments. It
so
is late in all of
the
European
want.
Countries. Let's get this underway, though. Are you ready?
Yes, let's give the people what they want. Some Age of Empires.
What map is this again? Hudson Bay.
It's Hudson Bay.
All right. The Winter Spawn, by the looks of it. All right, 3, 2, 1. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Winter Championships. Truly the Winter Championships. We are on a wintry spawn of Hudson Bay. Isn't that fitting and wonderful? And there is 40 wood in his base with a polar bear treasure. He has seen it. That's going to be perhaps useful. Actually not. No, he's only got 100 wood. He's not going to be, or is he? Is there a market? No, he's going to be going for the house. Not going to be building a market there. Not going to be buying the wood for a house with that coin. We do have $3 from Fighting Frenchman. These donations tax distributive.
Tax deductible.
Oh, are we, okay, we're money laundering. Yes, that's exactly what we're doing. All of these donations are to avoid.
If you have a record of it and you actually itemize in the U.S., you probably could make these donations tax deductible. Correct. But Kanisi going for 125 wood treasure here, and Lord Raphael above him getting a 60 wood with no knowledge of the 125 wood. I'm really unfortunate for him to miss that, and you're just going to be out that 65 wood as a result. Nothing he could have done here, really. I mean, he's scouting. Maybe the envoy path is a bit questionable, and he's going to pay the price for that. But he sees the polar bear die at the edge of his vision, too, and I know he saw that based on the way he's walking.
Yeah, he's heading towards that there. Perhaps he expects perhaps a second polar bear that he might still be in combat with. Actually going to give on with that. But yes, Khaleesi does pick up the 125 wood treasure. That's going to be really good for him. And now suddenly he's decided collecting the coin is a good idea. I wonder why that would be. Of course, he's going to get that market down now with that wood. And of course, only needs to gather a tiny bit more resources to get the hunting.
I like this move by Lord Raphael, though. Look, he's getting in his opponent's base. And he's going to steal that 40 wood, which it's going to even it up, right? 100 wood versus 125 wood. Yeah. Pretty much banging even, but then you also have it just kind of denies that free 40 wood that Khaleesi probably would have taken later. Khaleesi though working on 150 food, and the envoy will scout this. You almost want the TC to shoot at the Dutch explorer here just to make sure he can't get down there and contest you on it. But
I think you're I'm not sure where you're. Oh yeah, of course it's gonna get the. Yeah, so 150 food. Yes, we do see Lord Raphael in the blue player's blaze picking up that food, evening it up. But yeah, that means he's not out on the map looking for the bigger treasures here. 150 food. Looks like he's gonna take some extra damage from the envoy as well. But I don't think that explorer is anywhere nearby. Well, he's gonna have to walk a long way. He's not gonna get there in time. But certainly gonna do lots of extra damage. Hold on a minute. Is he gonna die? No, he's not. He's definitely going to get this treasure.
So close.
It's getting rather close. Hold on a moment. He still has to get to the treasure. He's quite far away from it. He's got, at the end, when this fight resolves, he's going to have very little hit points. 30 hit points? No, it's not going to be enough, is it?
He's still going to die.
Five-hand attack. He's going to die, yes, but he's going to pick up the 150 food. I thought perhaps, what if he died before he got to the treasure? But that is not the case. Still going to die, but does get very, very nice treasures. And arguably, perhaps, win age one. But then again, does lose his explorer. I'm not going to be too happy about. Schooners does arrive, but what do you think of all of this?
So I think overall, Raphael could really easily win age one here. I mean, he can pick up 61, 150 coin and 135 XP for free now. If he's on top of his age one mechanics here, it looks like he is. He's going to go for this 150 coin treasure. And although Khaleesi did take the early lead with the extra 150 food, obviously, in his bank, he didn't age any faster because of it. So it's not 150 coin is actually better than 150 food once you start aging up. You know, I mean, at this point, coin is just a more expensive resource, and it's that simple.
Especially as Dutch, right, where your villagers cost that, it's, you know, and it's very, very valuable, of course. 150 gold, absolutely. Food, not going to help you age up, as you mentioned. But, okay, so I suppose we can say red player, Lord Raphael, winning age one here. But the matchups, we introduced the Portuguese player, but clearly we have a Dutch player here for Lord Raphael, as I mentioned. All the villagers now switching on over to, of course, wood. He wants to stockpile that up. Almost has all of that 350 wood and food he needs for that first bank. Going to slam that down during transition, and then I imagine collect more food and wood. Certainly we'll get 400 wood as when he ages up, and that'll be another bank, I would imagine, and certainly has shipments that will get more banks. And
jeez,
the Dutch agenda. 90 food up here as well.
Look at that dock. That village going to place a dock over there. The other one, sorry, the villager that's going to place the dock, I should say.
Alright. Wow, that is a... That dock's on the other side. What? That's...
I've played some practice games where we were doing... Age was trying to play port the way Khaleesi would against Yumiu. And he even went as far as to do this, like where you just build your docks like this and you basically just can't lose water from here, right? So it's pretty much up to Lord Raphael to win the land hard enough, just from having that dock go down. It's up to Lord Raphael to win the land hard enough to make it not matter that he has water.
Yeah. You keep going.
And so looking at this, I mean, we got a second bank coming down, as you predicted. And with 700 wood, we might even see just two more banks. Just like the straightest of the four bank FF you could possibly do, or maybe even a six bank. I wish we had Mido here, because he's all up to date on the new ways to play Dutch that don't suck. And I know Raphael knows some of those. I don't know. I have no idea anymore. But it looks to me like this is going to be a four bank straight FF, like where you just literally only, you don't even build a market or anything else. You just, bank wagon coming. So
is this Khaleesi building the Huron settlement?
Huron? For the, they have a fishing tech that's really good.
Okay, how much is it that they grant?
I don't know. He's teching it, sadly, so I'm going to have to pop over to Lord Raphael and hold down alt.
He's not teching it for me.
I can't see it. He's already gotten it. Oh, no. Yeah, I'm ahead of you a little bit. But he's teching it, so maybe you can check real quick.
Is he? Let's switch on over to Khaleesi. Yeah, he is. Hold down alt, you say?
No. Only on TV. Someone knows. It's probably like 20% or something ridiculous.
If he's building 200 wood worth on a trading post, it's definitely going to be valuable, right? But let's take a look at the Khaleesi here. We do have $6 from ZutaZuta. And there's the last one. Hashtag 250. KeepDoingYourThing.com. Thank you very much, Azuta, but you shouldn't have said your finish, because then you might lose your space on the leaderboard. For those,
I think he's trying to bait people into going in even deeper.
Oh, I see. Okay, maybe that was a good idea. And it looks like this explorer is getting fairly low on health there. Is he going to get it back to his town? Yes, he is going to be able to do that. But for those of you watching the VOD wondering why we're talking about money so much, of course, all of these donations are going to fund future events. Very generous of the community. And I think we're well over $700 now, maybe $750 in a single stream. So thank you so much to the community for funding basically a whole tournament. We're really, really proud of that. And of course, this tournament is brought to you by ESO-community.net. ESO-community.net. If you'd like to donate to that, you can do on the site. Or if you're watching this on YouTube, there'll be a link in the description. So thank you very much, everybody. We appreciate just the viewership, but this is really quite overwhelming. But what are we looking at, H2O? Bring us up to date.
Yeah, so bringing us to speed here, we got four Huster on the map. Can't really do much with them. I mean, you look at Khaneesi's position. Sure, there's a couple of straggler builds, like this one build on this hunt, but does it really matter when you've got both Khaneesi's cranking out Kray CDB, the Kray discount on the wood, he's getting dock techs to make his dock fishing boats gather faster, Huron tech. I mean, this is the boom to end all booms at this point.
We're at 645, by the way.
Yeah, yeah, and once these couple of pikemen come out, if you switch over to Khaneesi's view, he's starting up some pikemen. Once those come out, I see the end of, I guess, any harassment from these Hussar, and just an incredibly strong position for Khaneesi. I don't see how Khaneesi could lose from this position, honestly. I mean, obviously he can, but I'd much rather be Khaneesi right now with the level of boom he's established.
Yeah, so many boats, right? 38 there, and in a very good position at the moment. With all of these, yeah, the Huron, as you mentioned, Kree, you're going to start training the CDBs. Or is it, yeah. Is it Bas? I don't know, do you get a shipment of four? It's one of them.
No, you can train them. This is the trainable 5 CDB limit he has now. Yeah. And he is training.
I think it's Cherokee that gives you the ability to get 4 in a tech or something. But yeah, Khaneesi, what has he done so far? Let's take a look. As a result of this boom that we're talking about, he sent schooners, as we can see there, 700 and 600 wood to fund all of the docks and fishing ships and all of those things. 700 gold now has arrived. It's going to help him get up to the next stage. These pikes nicely going to take out these two cav, which have gone idle. Their pikes very, very strong against the cavalry, as we know. And looks like he's just going to go all in on with those two cav and finish them up so they won't chase him around and be a nuisance. But yeah, you know, all of these things, Khaneesi in a very good spot. I'm going to be going up to the Fortress Age, where he's going to be able to pump out lots and lots of units. Those dragoons are very, very strong. We do have $2.50 from Fighting Frenchman. This game brought to you by Turkey Hill Chocolate Peanut Butter Cup Ice Cream. Absolutely. That's quite the mouthful. Thank you very much.
That was a very specific donation.
It very much was so. Musketeers coming out, though, for Khaneesi. Going to finish up these cav here, and we'll switch over to Lord Raphael and see. Yeah, Dutch player. Not in the same spot for blue here, is he?
I don't know if Lord Raphael has any idea how behind he is right now. He's sending 8 pike, and that tells me he has no idea how behind he is.
He's not sending 8 pike for me.
He canceled it. He canceled it. It's just now. Oh. It's funny. Like, when you toggled over, he canceled it.
Oh, yeah, just as I toggled.
Yeah. I think he's just trying to make you feel like we're desynced. I'm watching very closely. I'm at 840 right now, and you're at 841, so we're right on par. But he did cancel his spikes. Lord Raphael setting up his own Kray TP, getting his own market upgrades right now, and looks like he's gearing up for a Fortress Age transition here. Gonna need all that tech to be able to start breaking some ground on the land, because the water is definitely not happening for him.
Yeah, no, that's not going to happen there. And it would be very difficult to get that as Dutch anyway to begin with, right? You would want to spend all that wood on perhaps banks early on. You're not going to be building docks and... but I suppose those caravels is an option. What is this?
There's also...
Pre-textile craftsmanship coming in. I believe that's... I'm not sure what that does.
Where is that?
Lord Raphael.
This is the big one. This is the big Kray tech. 25% off all wood cost on buildings.
Oh,
so
wow.
Banks are cheaper, houses are cheap. It's basically like Heavenly Kami plus 2 on all your houses, right? And every other building. So
would it be worth ever getting that tech before you get any banks down?
And not before any banks, just because it's expensive and it takes you'll notice it's like it's got one of the longer train times of any tech in the game. It's almost like an age up, right, tech in this thing. So
yeah, that's true.
Usually it's one of those things where you want to get it started early, and then, you know, just ideally want from then on out, use it to your advantage. But Lord Raphael right here, I mean, look at his he's got one stable. He's going to send 1k wood, I guess, but it just doesn't feel like he's got a lot of threat coming anytime soon. And Khaneesi, meanwhile, is just on a rampage right now. He's got all the dock upgrades, kind of long lines is coming in, and then he also got the Huron tech even. He's Kray booming and 2TC booming, and he's going to be Fortress. at the same time as Raphael.
Fortress Age has just hit up there, but yeah, both players now up, and 53 villager population with all the upgrades that you mentioned. Lord Raphael, 28. Yes, these banks count for 4 each, but still going to be behind there. First shipment is 1k wood, as you mentioned there. That's going to fund more housing for the rest of this Fortress Age army, and possibly some barracks if he needs them, of course.
He needs a racks, a stable, he needs more stuff.
Yeah, Reuter's now coming out, though. They're the first things he's going to be training, and they'll be heading on out into the map, perhaps to do some damage to villages. But meanwhile, Kinesi has his extra town center, going to secure more of the map down here in this location, where there's, you know, plenty of hunts sort of behind that TC and a little bit in front of it as well, as we can see here. A wall going down the middle of the map, and behind that is another town center, which again secures the hunts nearby as well. So looks like he's definitely very much set up to go into the late game, has a stronger economy, and is going to be able to pump out more units as a result of that. 3 points been shipped, going to lock down his position on the water. That's a very strong shipment rate.
Yeah, I mean, he's just in a phenomenal position. I don't know. I really feel like Raphael's build has ended up, like, I think he had different intentions with this game, and it's kind of just turned awkward for him. Like, now he's got, look at his bank, it's so full, but he's just waiting on 1k wood to start spending it. He's got 3 flouts queued up, I guess, which is kind of random to me. You know, I mean, everything's just kind of random to me. It felt like everything was just a bit out of order for me. And that's why I think we're seeing Kinesi being able to hold so easily against what could have been a very strong Dutch timing.
Mm. Yeah, these 3 floats is strong, and they're gonna, you know, harass these fishing boats quite a lot. Kinesi's response to that, though, no response just yet. It's actually not too bad, I suppose. He's gonna deal with the ocean there. But you mentioned this Dutch timing. You think that might be a stronger thing to do? You know, not send that and instead like push out on land with something else.
It's actually turned out really well. I mean, he killed a lot more boats than I thought he would, and he's forced a response shipment. Alongside this, you really want to see Raphael come really hard here with the Reuter cannon, which is what it looks like he's going to be doing. And you can see already she's got the Falcons in queue, and that's going to be really hard for Kinesi to deal with unless he's already started culverin production, and I don't see that anywhere.
No, that's by the looks of it.
I mean, when 4 Falconets rolls up on your TC, it dies pretty fast, right? I mean, 800 damage a shot, it's going to be dead pretty fast.
Yeah, and you'd like that to happen sooner.
I'd like it to happen right now. I'm waiting for it. It's going to happen. I mean, he's going up to the water. Interesting. Raphael is just all about the water, and I feel like this might be a big blunder. The land eco is so spread out for Kinesi and so vulnerable.
Yeah, but this is how he won the previous game, I suppose. Perhaps he wants to do that here with Dutch. I mean, I have a feeling he would quite like to play French again, but what was the Sibley play last time? He'd like to play that one here. Portuguese, not French. But obviously cannot do that.
Yeah.
Anyway, doing the same thing with Dutch here, and I don't know.
If this frig dies, oh my gosh, if this frig dies, then all of a sudden the water might very well just go to Lord Raphael. Yeah. And by the way, Dutch really likes water too, because their villager limit is 50. So, you know, it's actually really good to have a couple of those on Wales as the Dutch civilization. And look at all these fishing boats. It's a lot of that represents a lot of villagers dying here. If they do end up coming out of that dock, and I don't see how he's going to stop it.
Yeah, no, he's not going to be able to stop it, is it? It's going to go down. He's got the cannons firing that down as well. All of these boats do come out now. Lord Raphael on 37 villages plus all of the banks. Now let's take a look at Kinesi. He is on 66, but certainly is going to lose all of these fishing ships. They're still ahead, though, as a result of his town centers, I suppose. But we have to remember the banks. We have to add them up. So probably, I'm not sure what that is. But Lord Raphael in a very good position as a result of playing it like this. He's just, it feels like Kinesi wasn't able to grab
that. I think he caught him off guard.
In a minute, yeah. 3 floats is a strong shipment, I think.
3 floats is a great shipment, by the way. He's also going 2 caravels, just to totally double down on the water here and make sure that he's able to clean these docks.
Yeah.
I think he was tired of making that mistake in the other game. And a frigate does manage to finish, though. And Kinesi's got a full HP frigate versus a pretty low HP one, but and these goons also potentially is going to sneak in here from the back and distract the Falconets a little here.
They
Kinesi
are.
Still trying to
how much damage
crazy.
Is he
going to
get on those Falconets? This is the question. Look, they're going to go down. Doesn't look like he's going to lose any. But yeah, that frigate moving around, he's going to be trying to focus. If there are any low HP boats he can focus down, doesn't look like it. Looks like he's going to grab the control of the water there And that puts Lord Raphael in very good spot. He's very heavily invested in this, right? He's got all of those upgrades, the Huron upgrade, the gill nets upgrade, the long lines upgrade, the rendering plant upgrade for his boat. And of course, actually, I think Khaleesi's sent improved warships as well. That's how invested he is in this water.
Yeah, and look at Lord Raphael. He's going industrial behind it.
Wow, really? Holy, where does he find the resources for that?
From banks. He's gotten full six bank. Ooh, these falconets are packing, though. And they unpacked, and it just really depends on how well these volleys go off on these castors, honestly, as to how alive his push is.
Gonna do the MLG 360 shoot! Nope, they got... Oh, yes, yeah. It is! It's an MLG 360!
MLG 360!
Yeah, there it is. It's gonna go into hand combat, though, but how...
Wow.
That's a lot of damage. Was it worth doing?
Yeah, I mean, this game's gotta be going in the favor of, it gotta be going in the favor of Lord Raphael here. I don't see, but a frigate does pop out, and that, maybe he bought the time he needed, Khaleesi did. Yeah. He still has a lot of bills, he still has a lot of boats in that dock, and sure, Raphael's gonna get industrial, but, I mean, he's still got a long ways to go here. I mean, Khaleesi's by no means out of this.
No.
Would have been nice if Raphael popped some docks up behind this, it might have been even nicer, right? I mean, he could have had one more frigate. If he had one more frigate, he would have taken the water.
He's going to walk around the back there, force the villagers into the town center. He doesn't have any sort of land presence to deflect this. He's going to be belled up inside his TC, and there's nothing he can do about that. He has nothing on the land. I mean, certainly a lot of his villagers, I don't know why I'm flaring, I guess I'm so used to it, are not where his reuters are, so they're not going to be belled. But it looks like, yeah, they're going to move around. They're going to cycle through all to the different locations the villagers could be at. And, you know, reinforcements arriving. More falconets, more reuters. And it looks like the blue player is back on the water there. But, yeah, two frigates do come out. But is that enough? Lord Raphael now up to the industrial age. Gonna get those upgrades out. He has lost the water. Where are we?
Yeah.
I mean, the scores would say Lord Raphael is winning, but I'm not certain.
I think we're at the point where if I were Lord Raphael, I would make two mortars and just part and clean out the entire bottom half of the map, because you know you have 50 reuters and your opponent has nothing. He spent all of his army fighting your cannons ineffectively to get the water back.
All right.
And wow, looks like Lord Raphael taking this game. That is unbelievable. Lord Raphael just crushing Khaleesi's ports on water here, and we will be going into the next game here, right? So
yeah.
Wow. I mean, I thought Khaleesi still had a little bit of life left in him, did you?
Yeah, it felt like it. I mean, he had plenty of villages, right? If we switch on over to Khaleesi, there's 69 villages, and that's a lot. He can, he doesn't have that much food. Perhaps that he's struggling to deal with the land presence, but, I don't know, he's back on the water. Felt like he had a bit more to give, but I can see that he is objectively behind. Now his opponent's up to industrial. Maybe that's what it was really, really screwing him, because he knew he wouldn't be able to get up to industrial, and once things like mortars and monitors do start coming out, perhaps he realizes that the game is over for that point. Yeah, I think it is Lord Raphael favored, but, you know.
So we're on match point for Lord Raphael, aren't we?
We are.
Unbelievable. And we will pop into the next game on Bengal, which to me feels like if there's ever a time to beat Khaleesi, it's on Bengal, right? Surely playing against the god of water himself. But to be fair, Lord Raphael is the new god of water. I mean, we just saw him totally turn the tables on Khaleesi in every single water map so far. So
yeah, he played that. I mean, you were skeptical about the way he was playing that, where he was sending his units. And
even the fluke shipment,
you didn't like that too much. But I think Lord Raphael really, you know, telling us how to actually deal with water in a very effective way.
Yeah, I mean, it's very impressive.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to end that recording there. Thank you very much for watching. We'll be back with the next game in just a moment.
And I will do a quick donation update. I think, you know, no more donations since Turkey Hill have come in, so I think we're good for a quick update on that. Pop that in there, but I'll save as. Donation, save, replace.
Update hype, that's right, Zua Zua.
Did he donate? I hope he didn't donate just to troll
me. Quick, everyone donate $2.
Yeah, please don't. You can. I mean, I
don't
I
give
love
me money.
Don't give me money until I update it. Well, if you do, it's too late. The cutoff has been reached. I pulled the latest stats, so there will be no more. I'm just not at the point where I'm trying to get it saved because my computer sucks. All right, that's saved. We need to create a new magical filter that says if your name is violinist misspelled, then now it's actually violinist spelled correctly.
Hmm. Metis is a know-it-all. $2 from Fighting Frenchman.
Metis is, a lot of people have come back to the community who were saying they were going to leave, which is also, it's nice to see people coming back. I think Metis was one of those people.
Well, that's nice. Jim Lean's going to switch to mobile, lying in bed, he says. I don't blame you at this point, quite late in Benevolence.
Yeah, we've had just such an exciting evening here.
Yeah, it's been exciting. And then,
Oh, Zuda has taken handily taken the lead at this point.
Yeah, Venny was playing games on stream the other day. That's true, Bubble Boo. Did anyone ever play the cookie counter with Cookie Monster? Question mark, say Zuda Zuda.
Oh, I had
the last main emu. The last game was won by Lord Raphael. It was Dutch versus. Come on, I know this. The comments are online, but games. Oh, we do have $2 from Multiplex. 999. We should give some money to Kinesi so he can buy better hardware or connection.
He is going to need that to play in the next tournament. We are planning to address that. Just not. We don't. Obviously, it's something that's hard to do, but you know, no one wants to.
To buy a new computer, $2 from Fighting Frenchman.
Oh, nice. Unfortunately, I just need to reinstall Excel. Whenever I open it, it's not happy with me. All right, I have the newest Dashboard Arena.
Dashboard Arena.
We have a couple new people making the list, and obviously a shake-up at the top with Zuda just going absolutely ham here. Okay, I've sent you the latest.
$220. I'm fairly certain he was at 250. There must be some spelling errors again. 220 at Zufa Zuta Zuta, 140 to Violinist, 101 to Goodspeed, 50 to Jerem, 50 to Purple Squid, 30 to I Will Spank You, 22 to Gaming Violinist, spelled incorrectly, 11.1 to Gaia AoE 3.
You have the wrong one, then. The heck? Spelled incorrectly, that should be off of there. Oh, no, it's not. Okay, you have the right one. Crap. Okay, yeah, keep going.
11 to Garrus Castros, 10 to Martin's Dave, 10 to Sir Callan AOE, and 10 to White Baskets. Thank you, everybody on this list, and everybody who is not on this list. All of those random $2 do add up, and very exciting stream. Very happy about this. How many viewers do we have? That's interesting. 184.
Yep, and alright.
Yeah, there'll be a news post about all of this later. What we just did there was H2O pulling stats into Excel in a period of about a minute and a half. But yeah, all your money is counted, and we are very very appreciative for it. Let's head on into the next game, though.
Yep, I'm already in game, ready to go, and I will also, while the game's in its early phases, I'll try to resolve some more of those misnamed things for people.
You're not going to focus on the game?
I will, but when you're doing introductions, it'll take me about 2 seconds to fix Fighting Frenchman's problem.
Alright.
Alright.
Let's get this underway. Alright, 3, 2, 1. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to game number 6 in this best of 7 series between Kinesi and Lord Raphael for the Winter Championships semi-finals. This is match point for Lord Raphael. Currently on 3 wins, 3 victories here, and a best of 7 means first to 4 wins will progress through to the next round, which is the grand finals. The loser will be eliminated. Can Lord Raphael here Well, this is Kanisi we're looking at here, playing Japan, actually. We'll talk about him first, then. Going to go for 100 food he has come across there. They're going to be quite nice for Japan there. Well, really, any treasure, like food or wood, any treasure is nice. But certainly food, they're going to get him aged up a little bit quicker to his 640 food goal, I would imagine, if he goes with the standard consulate and all, heavenly cameo and all of those things, which is quite likely, usually. But this is Kanisi we're talking about. We will see. But even, no, probably still very likely, of course. That guy likes to build walls and play defensively and all of these things. Almost lost his treasure by the looks of it to Lord Raphael there. Poof, he goes away. Let's switch on over, though, to Lord Raphael. Here he is, the guy on match point. Has elected to play British into his opponent's Japan here for this final game, potentially, for him. We'll have to see.
Yeah, I mean, interesting to see. I'm just so shocked that Kanisi has been so shut down in all the water games, right? I mean, I fully expected the typical Kanisi things to happen there in the last one. I'm still trying to recover, so
yeah.
It's going to be really interesting to see this land map. We saw this matchup on a land map earlier. It was Siberia, though, and that is a map where the flow of the game is kind of, so you spawn in the middle, right? And the flow of the game can go to either direction, and there's this huge barren wasteland of ice in the middle, which makes it a lot harder for other civs to kind of establish this control and this flow to the game that prevents shrines from going down. And now we go look at this map, and you run straight down that middle. There's that cliff at the top, and all the resources for contention are right in the middle.
Yeah, they are.
And furthermore, there's a lot of area that you can't even build.
What else is up for contention? We do have an 80 coin treasure. Both players are currently very, very close. Blue, of course, going to attack Red since he is being attacked by the Tiger. Wants to get the extra points of damage in. Who's going to go? Looks like Red, I think, got in there first. Lord Raphael picks that up. And rightfully so, since he was the one who was going for it in the first place. But Kanisi doing a good job, doing exactly what he needs to do to steal those treasures in those highly competitive matchups. Does get a significant portion of damage on his opponent's explorer. They're going to limit his ability to collect treasures. But fortunately for him, there isn't really anything else that requires much health to get, I suppose. So that's not going to be too much of a problem. We do have $2 coming in from Fighting Frenchman. Seize the means of production. Thank you very much, he says. I mean, I say to him saying that. All right, well, there is that. Lord Raphael, about to age up, has almost all of the food he needs for that. What's going on? Let's switch over to Kanisi. Yep, he is aging up as well. Both players off to an ice start. Who won age one, though? That is the question. Where you at? I am not sure where H2O has gone.
Oh, what the heck? I was muted for a second. I was going to say, I have to say, Kanisi definitely winning age 1 here. The 100 food and the 50 wood, two very relevant treasures in this matchup, and 80 coin just isn't going to compare for that. Obviously, Kanisi even almost matching that with a 40 coin, and he still has 90 wood in the back corner of his base, which I imagine he'll pick up at some point. It's down a bit, but down below the TP. But so overall, I would say, you know, positioning-wise, and the outcome of this has been Kanisi favored.
Yeah, Kanisi favored. But the interesting thing, I suppose, is what is Kanisi, what is his agenda now? Of course, going up with Toshogu Shrine, and he's now going to add in his... Did he ever build a consulate? I imagine he did. Where is it? No, he skipped his consulate. What do you think of that?
I don't know. I mean...
Has he got a different build in mind, then? Is he
sent
play?
Two villagers first. His deck is called Dev 2 versus Indy. So...
Alright.
Interesting. If we knew French, maybe it would be a bit easier, but what I see is debt, maybe it means two vills, right? Two vill versus India, maybe. Maybe this is a build against something a bit more aggressive that he's expecting?
Yeah, so, what, coming out of British? Well, we do see two forward villagers coming down. Let's switch on over to Lord Raphael and see what he has. He's about to hit up. Perhaps he is going to place a very, very forward race facing Rax. And
yeah, this is where you want the Rax to be.
Yeah, and perhaps this is an adaptation by Kanisi to perhaps something that he is expecting that will be more aggressive. And certainly, you know, Heavenly Cammy, well, two villagers is still an okay shipment, but
over
a longer period of time, Heavenly
Cammy
is far better.
He opened with the four vill shipment, too. I think what this is just actually a really smart adaptation to what I was talking about earlier, which is that it's very hard to control the shrines out in the middle of the map, especially against British, who's going to have units before you.
Yeah.
So he's opting instead just to send two vills, concede that he won't be able to get the shrines out there, and instead is just going to keep a couple of shrines close to his base and make units right away.
Yeah, okay. But it feels like... It doesn't feel as strong as ordinary Japan.
Nope.
I feel like other civilizations can do this better, right? How can we pick Japan? What was his decision here? Is there anything worth playing Japan in this matchup compared to any other? Now, I mean, he lost the previous game, therefore he gets to pick this civilization in response to what Lord Raphael picked. Why this against British on this map?
So I think he just did it. He has three civs he can play. Ports, Brits, Japan. And he just cycles through those civs. Ports always on the water map, Brits, and then, you saw his Aztec, right? His Aztec was nothing to write home about. Mm. So I think he just kind of got forced into a corner because of his lack of diversity.
Are these musketeers going to see the pikemen? No, they do get away here. They're going to come out and try and siege them down. So lack of diversity, you think it might be. And that could be it. Playing a civilization that he's conquering with, I suppose. Pikemen.
Yeah, and interestingly enough, we've seen a lot of civs from Raphael that have not been very common either, right? We've seen British twice now. We saw Dutch. Maito, the only other person who I've seen play Dutch in the tournament as a higher rated player. Kind of interesting to see that coming out of him as a response to Kanisi's kind of set civ pool. But if you think about it, British does really well against Japan, and Dutch, as we were shown, does very well against ports. So
yeah. It does take out the explorer there, and has managed to kill a number of pikemen, but
yeah, but at what cost, right? I mean, he's gone, you think about it, he's gone for Fourville first, which is nice, but he doesn't even have a consulate, and he's sitting on 60 Shrine Pop, and I know Zoot is watching this thinking, there's not enough port consulate, there's not enough shrines right now, and so does it really matter if you kill a couple pikes? Because effectively, Kanisi's just made a giant drag box over the middle of the map. Yeah, cover.
It's
nice.
Providing
the damage from
the spikes. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, it's a different style of play, and we have to remember here, Japan isn't that powerhouse at the moment that it ordinarily would be. Consulate is going to go up in this later portion of the game by the looks of it. It'll be interesting to see which person he allies with. He'll no doubt pick one in just a moment. He has the export for that, of course. You start with the export for that. It'll be interesting to see what he does go.
Sure.
Doesn't pick it just yet. We'll have to come back to that, I suppose, because not going to pick it right now. But has some Ashigaris out on the board. Has managed to kill a couple pikes in the explorer here, pushing back the British longbowman and the pike bowman. And still hasn't... Oh, he's going with the Japan. So 5% to land units. That's what he wants here. Completely skipping the Portuguese.
I think he wants the wagon. He wants the wagon for a stable. I'm guaranteeing it. He's going to go for that. And I don't think it's going to pan out for him just because of the amount of... Like, you'll see that it's just the longbow count's going to keep growing from Lord Raphael. And...
Shinobi no monos are coming out.
Oh, wow. What the heck? Who does that? And he's also shipping 5 Yumi. I don't understand. I don't care what he's doing at this point. Whatever he's doing, I'm willing to... to flip my coin and say that it's not going to land on Kanisi's face after this. He's almost housed at 56 out of 60 pop on Japan. He does have 4 Nagis coming out, though. I mean, so...
Well, these things, they certainly have a good range.
That's the only scary thing about the situation. If Lord Raphael gets sufficiently sandwiched here, I mean, you look at the Ashy flank, this could be quite a scary timing if it's all coordinated correctly, but... After this, if this is survived, I think this is the game-defining moment.
Yeah, more longbowmen coming into the fray to join the fight here. Going to be very good against those Ashies. And of course, these pikemen, they've done a reasonable job killing off the nag, and that is going to continue to perhaps get one more maybe with that pikeman. No, there's just 2 nags here. Looks like Japan is going to come out, I think, on top in this fight. Certainly with the longbows that are closest to him. These 5 longbowmen in the back that are going to join the fray are really going to, I think, put this in British favor. That's only 1 cavalry left, and then suddenly everything he has is quite good against everything else here. He does have 4 nags. That is about to arrive, and that is very, very meaningful. That's going to be exactly what he needs to deal with these longbowmen. Switch over to Lord Raphael. He does have more pikes joining the fray. That's going to counter that up, and longbowmen look like they want to get back, or they're not going to push forward just yet. They're waiting for the pikes to arrive. Cav going to run in there. They want to do lots of damage to those longbowmen, but we know there's pikemen. I guarantee the longbowmen... Okay, they're going to continue. Yeah, they are going to get back, okay. And now going to set up and do their animation whilst these pikes are covering them there.
Yes,
sir. Yep.
Remember we talked about this, how good Longbow and Yumi are against Cav, right? It makes it a lot harder to Cav surprise these 2 civs, and right now trying quite hard Kanisi is to do that, but I mean look, there's still a couple of pikes left in there in cover mode, just soaking damage, and but Raphael actually transitioning a bit to muskets, which I really like that. I think it's going to do very well against everything that Kanisi's going to have left, with just, he's got a handful of Longbow in there just to kind of deal with the handful of Yumi that'll be left, but musketeers do well against both.
$10 from Biddy Badass, 1991. No message. Thank you very much, Billy. We do appreciate that. You like the muskets?
Yeah, I do. I think it'll be a solid transition, and I think it's going to be just what he needs to ensure he doesn't get like Muscat's being such a versatile unit. It's going to ensure he's got what he needs to not get surprised by anything.
Yeah, thank you so much though. $10. That's quite the amount. You know, we was expecting a couple $2. Right. Like the generosity today has been huge. $100 in a single nation is just monstrous. Some people really going all the way. So thank you so much. Definitely going to be more tournaments to come in the future. That's really good here. But yeah, longbowmen, musketeers, adding those in as well, and certainly pikemen that he had remaining that he had early in the game when his economy was very much food and wood.
That five ashy pick, so huge. Every unit counts.
I wasn't looking.
You saw it. You were right there, weren't you?
I thought you meant just now.
No, he picked off 5 Ashes with his longbow, and like you look at his military population, it's not that high. You can't be throwing away 5 Ashes when you're sending 5 Ashes as a shipment.
And look, now he's going to push in onto the base, and I don't really think there's much that blue player can do about this. The Khaleesi on 37 vils with 80 part shrine pop. Yeah, the game ends just there. Look, let me switch over to Lord Raphael, 40 villagers. Actually, it's fairly even in terms of villages. I'm surprised about that, considering... I guess they do have 2 4 vill shipments. Actually, Japan's not too bad in this style. But it certainly is better in the other style. But you can't deny, you know, Lord Raphael, unit control excellent, unit selection excellent, manages to come out on top of those fights, and is now going to push into his opponent's base and does end the game. And that is the end of the series. Lord Raphael does pick up this game and does therefore progress to the grand finals, where he will be facing, actually I won't say it because I don't want to say it in the VOD because other people may, depends which order you watch the VODs in.
Yeah. So we won't say it here, but I think everyone in the chat knows the outcomes from earlier. Thank you for watching, and thank you for all the donations as well. We do have, I wanted to mention that these results were spoiled by a lot of people, but I think that it was like a giant intentional troll, because I was told several times that actually Khaleesi won by like 3 or 4 different people, all of whom it came from different people. So it's kind of interesting that I was, when I saw the Dutch win, I was shocked, I think we all were in the chat.
I think that colored the commentary and the thought. I would prefer to not have any kind of spoil. Well, no kind of, like, I know it, like the information we were told was erroneous, but I would prefer to have not been told anything, actually. But
because it can taint the thought process behind it.
But that is the end of the series, and Lord Raphael progresses. Khaleesi is eliminated. Thank you very much for what I'm saying. I've casted too many games today. It's been very, very fun, and. So thanks for watching. We'll see you all again next time.
And maybe we should do one more donation update message before the stream. There weren't that many donations that flew in, but I do want to very quickly just refresh from what we had before, and we will do a full news announcement. In particular, Fighting Frenchman, I just want to mention, before this game even began, he had donated $33, and due to some chart formatting that I was trying to do in the last second, so I didn't have him in there. So I'm going to send one more image before we wrap up the chat, to give people a mention, and there will be once again that full mention coming soon with absolutely the right numbers and everyone listed, including smaller donations, which are just as important. So I've sent it to you now, Interjection, just one last picture.
252 to Zuta Zuta, 167 to Gaming Violinist, 101 to Goodspeed. Holy crap, these individuals are nuts. Jerome 52, Purple Squid 50, Fighting Frenchman 33, I Will Spank You 30, I Am Soldier US 14, Gaia 11.1, Garros Castro's 11.1, Mammoth Smurf 11, Martin Salal 10, and Cycool and AoE. So cool.
The last one is the last one there being cut up is Whisker Basket with $10 as well.
Thank you so much to everybody who has contributed to the next tournament. I'm actually astounded that so much money was raised for the next tournament in such a short space of time. Just one stream. So thank you so much. And of course, to everybody else who is generating the random $2 here and there. I know not everybody can give as much as others. So all contributions are very, very appreciated. Thank you very much. And it's been a great evening. Really enjoyed today. And that does conclude all the Age of Empires 3 for today. But the grand finals, do we know when that will be happening? Can we tell the dear listeners when?
I guarantee you it's going to be next Sunday, unless something weird happens and it's next Saturday. But it's going to be next weekend. It'll be news posted and shared in as many places as possible. It will be casted for sure, hopefully by the Zooter Ejection combination. So
I like Zua. Yeah. Somebody says, what happens if the prize pool goes over 1,000? What if we raise more than 1,000? That money will go to the next tournament afterwards. If we have a giant surplus in bank, then maybe the prize pool will go up for particular events, or maybe the frequency of events will go up. I don't know. We'll spend it in a meaningful way.
It'll always go towards events. You're right on. It's going to go to future events. There are times when things get a little bit quieter on donations, and times when things get a bit faster. Obviously, this is the fastest day we've ever had, and you know, so we were honestly. I'd like to be funded one tournament in advance. So I'd like to fund two tournaments before I start thinking of other uses, just in case we do have run into any trouble. But you know, for now, it's just going to keep piling up. Right? We got to hit $2,200 before I start thinking about other things we can do with it. But we will come up with something.
Yeah, but that is it from us tonight. And perhaps next Sunday we'll see the grand finals. Either way, keep an eye on eso-community.net. That is where this tournament is brought to you by. It's been a good fun evening, as I keep mentioning. And I'm looking forward to seeing the responses on YouTube to these videos. So do leave comments and likes. Everybody casting loves to check those things. No matter who they are, they'll always be checking their casting particularly. And probably watching it back if they're anything like me and Zuta. Then, yep, I think that's it from us tonight. Again, thanks for watching. Do you have anything else to add before we go offline?
Just once again, big thanks to everyone, and please do check out esocommunity.net and get on the forums and start talking about the game.
Yeah, get on the forums. That's the important thing here. I think now we're going to host